The Daily Beast is reporting that Roy Moore was banned from a mall in the 80s. For pursuing teens.
Him and R. Kelly, boy.
An ivory dental specialist in the High Park area. 1040-42.
Hey, Louis C.K., man. What's up, man? You ever done that?
No, my name.
What? I mean, I didn't know it was something that people did.
I missed that whole story. I know a little bit about
it. Okay, the cameras are on.
What's the question?
I mean, he masturbates in front of women. That's so his thing. That's what he likes to do. He don't want to do nothing else. He wants, hey, baby,
that's
look here.
That's kind of weird.
Mind if I, like, you know.
That's kind of weird. Exactly
what he's trying to do. But he says it's everybody knew that that's what he does. I mean, there are hundreds of thousands, it's like he's not.
Currently benefiting do the women know?
Apparently they do now.
No, but he said he would go up to him. That's the way he would proposition a woman. He would go up to her and say, hey, look, baby, you know, this is what I like. And can I do this? Because he does it. But what he's saying is, he didn't realize that because he was in a position of authority or power, that they would be in a predicament to say yes. Whereas if they didn't know he was Louis C.K., he would go up and he would do that anyway.
Just for celebrity.
Huh?
It's the celebrity.
Yeah, he's like, he was just trying, he was like, he was, what is it? But Bruce Rauner's doing trading on his celebrity.
Governor, yeah. I'll
stand up. But it would be the same. Say, hey, baby, you want to go out and have a, you know, a couple of drinks?
He thought that was normal.
He thought it was very normal.
But he was married. So he never.
Oh, so he never cheated.
You can find Illinois' best products right in every corner of the store.
Well, he's not that bad of a man, right?
But he sort of had that as sort of something that he did. That's what he did. That's how he got his. That's how he.
That was his. What made him get off?
Yeah, that got him off.
Everybody got fetishes.
Right.
He fit right in the Cook County.
I like. It's what he
likes. He would fit in the Cook County.
I like it like that. You know, that's what he likes. You know, that's what he do. What do you do? What do I do?
He's like, you can do what there? Hey, can I do a charity event at Cook County Jail?
Like our Facebook page, get your chance to receive a group discount.
Stokely Unplug is powered by Lexis McGrath, Kluger Furs, and ComEd. This traffic report is brought to you by the T.J. Martell Foundation.
I know it's probably late. They should have went to Lober.
Leukemia, cancer, and AIDS through the T.J. Martell Foundation.
Lober Porn. Support helps facilitate then, like, instead of doing McGrath. More effective treatments and save right? Lives. And then they could have parked that summer gun right in the front. Been like, bring the new.
Man, it's,
Good morning, everybody.
You see the bull story, man? That's an interesting story, man. I think the Chicago Bulls.
If somebody whooped your ass, would you go back to work with him?
But I mean, he was like there. He was in the practice yesterday.
Not speaking.
In the background. Not speaking to anybody. On his phone. And then Bobby Portis was talking, man, looking like a maniac. I mean, because the guy, he got them bug ass. Like a psych ward. It looked like a complete psych ward.
And I bet you he went psych ward on your boy. Where's Sonya?
She hasn't texted me.
That's probably her calling on this hotline right here.
Yeah, she would call.
All right, y'all. Good morning. How's everybody doing? What up, Tammy Matthews? Tammy, I can't believe you left us and went to Atlanta. What up, Dennis Evans? What up, Big Nate? Linda Carter? Denise Sims, John Rembert, what up, Tahira? What up, tomorrow, Alvin E. Norton, Hotep. Oh, excuse me, that's Henry Hartsfield, Hotep. What up, Sharon Lyle? What up, Roderick Power? What up, Amina? See y'all tonight, Poli Sci 101, the final edition, rebuilding the black infrastructure. What up, Nanette Jones? What up, Ian Leverson? I hope everybody's good. What's up on YouTube Live? Shout out to Ronald Anthony. Corey Mack, Dennis Evans, what up TT, and what up Aunt Tennille? How is everybody doing? Let's get ready to rock this morning show. Hey y'all, I need you all to do me a favor. T today I'm going to be talking about it. But can you all go to Commissioner Carrie Steele's page and send her a shout out? It is our second wedding anniversary. And so when she wakes up, it'll be great if she could have some, you know, this show causes a lot of stress. So it would be wonderful if one day it didn't cause stress, but it caused happiness. So help a brother out. Commissioner Carrie Steele, tell a happy anniversary for your boy. Help me get back right. All right, y'all, it's time. Woohoo! Give me my screen. Let's get this show started. Hey, y'all, go on Instagram, see what I got my baby for her anniversary. Check out my Instagram page. Maze Jackson said, check it out. Time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much. I heard y'all love my singing, so I got to sing for you. There's so much hatred, war and poverty. Sharon Ugochi, this is for you. Oh, wake up all the teachers, make the teacher new way. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have. What up, Tahira? What up, Dennis? What up, John Rembert? Let's start from the bottom. What up, Roberto? What up, Patricia? What up, Amina? What up, Edwin Muhammad? What up, James Williams? Let's do it, y'all. The world won't get no better if we just be. The world won't get no better. We gotta change it. Wake up all the doctors, make the old people well. They're the ones who suffer and who catch all the hell. But they don't have so very long before that judgment day. Won't you make them happy before they pass away? Wake up all doctors, time to build a new land. I know we can do it if we all lend a hand. The only thing we have to do is put it in our minds. Surely things will work out. Let's do it every time. Come on, y'all. Come on. Sing it with me. The world won't get no better if we just let it be. Na 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 na. The world won't get no better. Good morning, Chicago. Good morning, world. This is the WVON Morning Show. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. Charles?
Hey, man, I'm feeling pretty good. Look, I heard it's your anniversary.
Hey!
Wedding anniversary. Congratulations to you and Commissioner Carrie Steele.
You know what, Charles Thomas? Thank you very much. It is my second wedding anniversary. And Charles, I must tell you, it has been a miraculous 2 years. It has been a miracle that my wife still stays with me after all the mess I keep up.
I gotta agree with you on that.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, I'm gonna be shouting out all day today. This is my wedding anniversary, and I appreciate you showing the love. Ooh, what you know about that? Right? It's our anniversary. Hey, but you know what? I cannot do the WVON Morning Show without the Morning Show team. Gotta say what's up to Annette Flournoy in the newsroom. Thank you, Annette. I appreciate it so much.
I mean, black love is a beautiful thing.
You know what? Black love is a beautiful thing, and I got plenty of it, and I'm going to be celebrating it today. Now, I'm working, y'all. I'm working in the morning. I'm working in the evening. So I'm going to need y'all to stand with your boy and help me show some love, spread it out, so I can get back in the bed. I need them petitions and a whole bunch of other stuff. Who has got all this noise going on? You got to stop it going on in the studio.
Oh, that's me. Must be me.
All right, man. That's what's going on. You got me confused. I'm hearing sounds and music.
Sorry about that, my brother. I can't get online here this morning, and I'm having a relationship.
Well, you see what? You know what? When the man come back to town, things start breaking down. When we had Black Sonya, didn't none of this. You know what, Charles? You come in, she would have your chair ready. She would fix your headphones. You know, she'd be like, oh, Charles, you sit down. Right.
Sausages and stuff.
We get treated like we somebody's.
Right.
The man come back, he like, back to the plantation.
Right.
back to your quarters. All right. Now, you know we got to say what's up to the musical conductor of the Soul Plane. Ladies and gentlemen, that is right. Miss Sonia Escobar. Sonia, how you feeling this morning?
Hey, you know what? I'm really excited for Poli Sci tonight.
Ooh, you know what? It is the final episode of Poli Sci, 4-week episode of social media miniseries. Everything you need to know, black people need to know about politics in Illinois. Tonight, we will discuss rebuilding the black infrastructure. But you want to talk about excited? Let me tell you what I'm excited about. The turkey race. We got the turkey race coming up again in the 8 o'clock hour. So it's your chance to win a free Thanksgiving turkey. WVON listeners, the WVON turkey race is coming up sometime during the show. Now, Birdie told me you need to tune in the 6-7, but in the 8 o'clock hour is when you got to listen real hard. Now, when you hear the turkey gobble, now, Charles, we said our turkey don't gobble. Our turkey say, gobble, gobble, ML, mofo, right? Gobble, gobble, mofo. We don't.
It's a mean turkey. What was that?
What is that? That's stop, knock, hello? What is that?
Come in, Annette, come in.
You knocking on the mic? Come on. We on air. Right?
Ladies and gentlemen.
Oh my goodness. All right. It is the WVON Turkey Race brought to you by Harold's Chicken, number 88, 124 East 35th Street, and Dat Donut, located at 8251 South Cottage Grove. This is the WVON Morning Show. I'm your host, Mace Jackson. Charles Thomas. We'll be back after traffic and weather.
More of the Morning Show with Mace Jackson coming up on the Talk of Chicago.
Come on, y'all. Like y'all tapping on the mic?
At my clinic, Body Genesis Chiropractic Center, you will find the latest and most effective techniques available to help you.
We get unbelievable. From people who tell Charles, you got the pills. Charles, struggling, you got the camera.
Man, I'm trying to get my internet to work. I can't get my internet to work.
The answer is almost always a resounding yes. Call me. We've helped thousands of people who have had these problems.
Can't get your internet to work. I can't do Facebook.
And every day we're changing lives. We offer intersegmental traction, myofascial release massage, and the latest chiropractic adjustments to get your life back. If you have a question, call us for a free consultation at 312-225-1100.
Oh, here we go. And on finally the web at drsolomon.net. Here we go.
That's DrSolomon.
I'm on. I'm back on now. Back in the game.
Our new state-of-the-art office in Aurora, Illinois, right off of I-80.
Kind of tough here. You know, we have some, like, on again, off again, internet here at WVON Radio at 1000 East 87th Street.
Two break-ins will have occurred.
How do we know?
Because every 13 seconds, a break-in is committed. Did you know most burglaries occur between 9 a.m. and 3 p.m., not in the dead of night, like in the movies? Did you know identity theft is the fastest growing crime in this country, and identity theft starts at home? And can you believe only 17% of homes in the U.S. have a security system? Don't be a victim. Every second counts. Call Secure Home and Automation, 708-251-5069. That's 708-251-5069. Secure Home and Automation. Every second counts.
All right.
Protect what matters most.
Morning, Jim. Want to try a new...
Got some stuff going. Can you hear me now?
Just a coffee. Why's everything got to be so complicated? Like those new smart meters.
That's not complicated.
Can you hear me now?
Smart meters give you access to more online tools and programs. They put you in control of your energy use, so you can save a little or a lot.
Technical issues going on this morning, but we're getting through them.
I get it. Make that coffee a large.
It's amazing that we can't do radio without
Learn more at comment.com/smartmeter. Comment, powering lives.
Hi, this is Cliff Kelly, the governor of Talk Radio.
Commercials are
my
super
favorite
loud.
Meal is breakfast, and my favorite place to enjoy it is at Miss Biscuit, 5431 South Wabash. Miss Biscuit's is the home of the plain-sized pancakes, golden brown French toast, delicious salmon croquettes, pork chops, and all those mouth-watering biscuits. I just got
man, quit talking about pork chops.
Miss Biscuits offers a biscuits? Family environment with food-like
goodness,
foods.
Cliff.
Miss Biscuit at 5431 South Long Beach, open daily, 5 a.m. What a great way to
man,
start your
day. Man, I might go
day.
Over there after the show. Give me one of the pork chops and egg breakfasts.
Where?
Man. Cliff talking about pork chops and biscuits.
Oh, Miss Biscuits.
Man.
Miss Biscuits is good.
Miss Biscuits is good, man.
You know, Peaches is good, too. Oh, I forgot. Peaches unsubscribed from my mailing list, so I can't speak on that. You heard that, Tenille? You heard that? I saw that. I saw that. I could be petty Tendergrass. Oh, my God. I'm terrible some days. All right, y'all. Polyside 101 tonight. Don't forget, Unplug WVON Thursday night. You know what, man? I was just thinking, Thursday night at 6 o'clock. Do you know what it's going to be like trying to get downtown to the Hard Rock, to Ontario, and man.
What do you mean, Uber?
It's not the point. I'm saying no matter what you in, it's going to be forever getting there. Right?
Yeah, you got to leave early. That's all.
I know. I'm not. See, Charles. See, you know. You know. The news start on time for you, right? The news start at 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock for me means we got to be leaving for this. At that time, you got to leave at damn near 5.
True that. You're gonna have to leave early, without a doubt.
All right, y'all. I need everybody. Do me a favor. Go on the Carrie Steele or Commissioner Carrie Steele page. And just say happy anniversary for your boy, okay? Just do that for me, all right? Say, we got your back, Carrie. Please help a brother out. This show, man, I'm telling y'all get me in trouble every day. I want to see all y'all down there. I don't care, whatever it takes. Hey, y'all, do that for me, okay? You know what, Alyssa, I'm sorry. I went out the room. I'll get it next time. What up, Sly? What up, Reese? What up, Amina? What up, Carol? Hey, y'all, go check out Instagram to see what I got Carrie for our anniversary. Check it out on Instagram. I don't know if she's awake and saw it yet. But if she does, I hope you like it, babe. Now, what I need y'all to do is help a brother get some petitions. It's the class. It's the end of the week. Last day. I'm just telling you, my baby is kicking butt on the petition. I don't want y'all to think she ain't, because she whooped butt. Levels. My level. Yeah. All right, Chicago WVON listeners, don't forget to get your tickets to Stokely, formerly of Mint Condition, for WVON's Unplugged Platinum Series. That's right, this Thursday, November 16th, the whole morning show team. Charles, what you over there, man?
I'm getting into this Stokely, man.
You're getting into this Stokely?
I didn't know anything about Stokely before this week.
Yeah, before this week.
Yeah,
then,
now I'm like, you I'm going...
You trying to get on the level.
What's that line?
Go ahead, do it.
No. Wait, give me the line. What's the line?
Levels. Oh, what you mean?
Level.
Look at that. Go ahead. Levels. Look, y'all. That is Charles, ladies and gentlemen. In case you are confused as to what radio station, that is Charles Thomas on the vocals. This is the WVON Morning Show. Charles. You know, Charles, are you in the church choir?
No. Never. I was never in the church choir.
What you waiting on, man? I know you got
to. The only time I ever made it to that part of the church was on Christmas and Easter when they did the play.
When they did the play. Were you the voice of God?
No, I was. I would do, you know, the poem. I would do a, you would do a presentation.
Oh, you do. You know, I used to
Sunday school.
What? Can I ask a question? I know I'm way off subject, but what happened to that? Do you remember when it was the annual Christmas play and everybody had a part? And you, I don't know, man. This electronic Christmas stuff
sucks. And the mega church has really put a damper on that.
Hey, man, Right.
The mega church.
And do you know what? And you know at the mega church, you probably got to pay like $10,000 for your kid to get the starting role. Right? Yeah. Like, it's, you know, they probably got A, B, and C team.
They just have a routine that they have to follow. Because right. There's so many people, you got to get them in and out.
You got to get that back. Amen.
Several services.
You got to get that. Do your church got one? Do they like them churches with the long-handled... The long hand offering, so nobody get to pass and pick.
No, you ain't never seen. Just put past the bucket along the long.
It's a bucket now?
Yeah, we have a bucket.
Y'all got a bucket. See, when I went to church,
each row gets a bucket.
A whole bucket. Is it like a bucket boy's bucket?
No.
Is it that big?
No, it's a smaller bucket than a bucket boy bucket, and it's usually made out of
gold
cardboard.
Oh, cardboard.
And you put your envelope in there, yep. Or whatever you want to put in there.
Straight envelope, man.
I do straight envelope. I tie.
You tie. It's, hey, man, that 10%, boy.
It's very important, my brother.
I'm going to tell you. You got to
try it. It works.
Hey, my brother, I tithe. You better speak for yourself. I just tithe. You don't have to go to church to tithe.
Well, you don't have
you
to.
You don't. And I know quite a few people who don't go to church
and tithe. You tithe.
Yes. With my time. With my time. And my talent. Yes, I tithe with my time and my talent. And then.
But you don't necessarily go to the building to do that.
No.
That's cool. I mean,
I give me my fill of Otis Moss and Joel Osteen, boy. Mm-hmm. I put my hand in the air at the end when they say, you know, and I'll be like, phew, got it in, boy.
I got it in.
Woo!
Man.
I'm going to tell you. I'll tell you.
I can't afford not to tithe.
Amen. You know, I'm going to tell you. I know that feeling. I'm going to tell you. I listen to Otis Moss right here on WVON. I know people think that might be catching me off guard. But, boy, I used to time my trips to the radio station so I could be in the car to listen to that brother because he had a lot of good stuff. But, man, we are all over the place today. Charles, you know, there's a lot of stuff that went on. Colin Kaepernick was named GQ Citizen of the Year, which is pretty cool. Alderman Cochran has called it quits after 3 terms. He says he believes in term limits.
So does the North District of Illinois.
You're bogus, man. You're bogus. You're bogus. Hey, man, I was watching City Council yesterday, watching the City Council meetings, and I am just letting you know that there is, I just want to put us on alert that the green team next gen is forming, and yesterday they were giving Mayor Emanuel some work on the City Council floor. I will come back to that at some point, but ladies and gentlemen, we got to put our next thing together. Charles, this story jumped out to me. So I'm reading through the newspaper, and I see a story about Common, Chicago's own Common, and now he is dating Angela Rye. Do you know who Angela Rye is?
Yes, I do. She's a CNN commentator, I think.
Right? Yes.
Yeah, and that she, woman. Yes, very, yeah, definitely.
She used to be the former executive director of the Congressional Black Caucus.
Is that what she's known for?
You know what? Don't you get no... There will not be a Me Too story here with Maze Jackson. So, Charles, you can go down whatever path you want, but on my anniversary, I get in enough trouble on this show as it is.
I think the first time I noticed her on CNN, it was... Not because of anything she was saying, let's say.
Her physicality?
Why did y'all do that?
You did it. You made the... Look. Angela Bassett, something about... No, you know, she is just an artist. Something about her physicality just moves me.
Let's move ahead.
Okay.
Let's move on.
So, Angela Rye, she caught you because of her intellectual... You were caught up in her intellectual spiel.
It wasn't about her intellectuality.
See? That meat stop. Look, Charles. Okay. Charles. You already yesterday was in... We
girl
don't want to...
Girl fine,
look.
Okay? Girl was fine.
You know what? Common. Hey, Common got a couple of yours, man. Because he also... You need to date Eric Badu, too. Now, check this out, though.
Baduism.
Common said that because he is dating Angela Rye, he has become more politically aware, and it has made him pay more attention to the issues that are impacting Chicago, particularly the violence.
Yeah, you gotta explain that to me. I mean, I'm trying to make that work, but you gotta explain his line of thinking, his...
I can't, really.
Connectivity of his... brain activity.
Hey, man, let me tell you, Common is a rapper, brother. And he has been blessed with a skill, and he got blessed with Angela Rye. So we just gonna leave it there. We'll talk about that. But it got me to thinking, because he said that Angela Rye has made him more politically aware. So
she can make a lot of people aware.
You're gonna be in rare form. Hey, Mary. Look.
Hi, this is Angela Bassett, and whenever I'm in Chicago, I listen to Mays and Charles on WVON.
Look, why you cheesing, dog? What's going on, man? Look at y'all, Charles.
She's a charm.
Charles is in rare form. Let me get this.
That's what you call games. That's game.
Rare form.
That's game.
Rare form. Look, y'all. Charles may not, he may come in here with a couple lumps tomorrow. Don't y'all trip. Now I'm telling you, I'm trying to help you, brother. Let me get the question out. So, do you believe that? Do you share the same political beliefs as your spouse? That is the social media question of the day. Do you share the same political beliefs as your spouse? That's something I'm pretty familiar with, and we'll talk about that, plus Angela Rye and Common, when we come back at 6:31 on the Talk of Chicago. Live
from James Williams.
Go ahead, what's the great point?
Common was dating Serena Williams. Remember that? He dated Serena Williams.
Serena Williams does not do it. Serena Williams is intimidating. I'm like, okay, look, Serena Williams walk in. She like, Mays, I want you. I'm gonna be like,
oh. I'm gonna go.
You gonna be?
I surrender.
You gotta be like,
I'll be walking out like, I'll be walking out the bunker, going, I'm gone. Please don't. Me, but I give up. I ain't fighting. I'm going to the prisoner of war camp. It's over. I ain't fighting no more. I got no fight left in your boy.
Oh,
yeah,
God.
Man.
Oh,
ain't no war. Ooh, no. Can't do this. Nah, I ain't.
There's rare form today, ladies and gentlemen. Let me say this is clearly going to be the rare form show today, because everybody's in rare form. Can I just get y'all to do me a favor, though? Can y'all please go to Commissioner Carrie Steele's page and just tell her you got her back? Can the people that watch this show on a regular basis, please do me a significant favor and let her know that you got her back? Do y'all understand that so many people come against her because of what I say, regardless of what she does? Help a brother out.
Come against who?
Commissioner Carrie Steele.
Commissioner Carrie Steele gonna win in a walk.
Hey, bro, you don't understand. Okay. Do you understand that Alderman Tony, not Alderman, do you realize that Pat Dow literally makes phone calls to elected officials to tell them to not support Carrie because of my show?
And because of this show? And her credibility level is what?
She's closing school. Tony Preckwinkle calls people and says the same thing.
That's what those inside politicians, man. They don't play out here. They're not playing out here this year. That is an advantage to Commissioner Steele, who is an incumbent as well. That if these people say don't, people will. Man, these people, man, I tell you, it's a new feeling out there, man.
So you got to understand, guys, for us, let me just say this, right? So for a person like myself, right, we grew up learning this system the way that it is. And so until we see it change, you're always leery or nervous. And so all I'm asking is for the WVON listening audience, for the Den, for all our people to show that it won't be the politicians are trying to make her pay for what I talk about, right? They want to hold Carrie, so they can't come in here and get me. So they try to go after her, and I have to be quiet about it. But today is my wedding anniversary. And I just need my wife to have some support, because the fact of the matter is, y'all, it's like this show is clearly stressful. People call and hate on her every day. Every day. And so the fact of the matter is, she has to stress over this show because she's still in the middle of an election. So I need y'all to get her back, right? I'm confident, but I'm only one vote, right? So I need y'all. Please and thank you. Hey, and if you can't leave a message on her page, inbox her. She need to know it's as many people. See, the thing is, until you get out the box, y'all, and this is all love. This is Maze Jackson talking. There's 200 people and there's 2 million people. We talking to 2 million. Let's go, y'all. I know exactly what you mean. Some of these people don't understand how it goes down inside the game, right? So it's when they try to get the election day move around, where they try to flip out and put somebody else on the palm card. But if you see somebody putting a black somebody going against her, they're not going against her because she's a chemist or an environmentalist. They're going against her because of Maze Jackson. And my wife, being a strong woman that she is, does not deny her husband, but she has her own mind and her own ability to fight the way she does. I need y'all to get her back. I don't get to talk about it because I don't want to get in trouble. But today, it's our anniversary, so I need y'all to help me out. Please and thank you. Look at you. It's you, Carrie. So heaven. And I'm not going to even sing it, so I don't mess it up. See, Sonya playing songs for your boy. You are tuned in to the Talk Chicago 1690 AM. Hey, Charles, I know, man, I'm being bogus today, but I got to send that to my one and only on our wedding anniversary. Ladies and gentlemen, that song goes out to Commissioner Carrie Steele, my beautiful and lovely wife. Thank you, baby. 2 years in the game. We doing our thing, Charles, but we are to the social media question of the day. Do you share the same political beliefs as your spouse or significant other? Well, you have a spouse. So
yeah, I have a spouse, and I think that when I mean, keep in mind, I'm a political reporter, man. I mean, I know the game, and you know, so when I bring everything that I know into our relationship, you know, my beliefs are probably more in line with hers and what she was when I got married to her. I'm telling you, man, I'm not gonna tell you what they are because that's her business. But I think I probably think more. I think she probably has been a bigger influence on me with all my political knowledge mm-hmm. than me on her. And I'll tell you why. She thinks more like real people think mm-hmm. about politics. And I learned from her because I see her sitting there. I'm sitting there reading the newspapers and reading the Wire and all that and trying to keep up. And she's sitting there watching Dancing with the Stars. And I'll say something to her, it's just set me straight. So I think more about politics that she does than what I used to. I think more about faith like she does than I used to. She's been a bigger influence on me because I think she's more normal than me. Ooh, man, did I just say that?
Wow. So, you know, Charles, I would say that let me go back. My wife and I met as young Democrats a long time ago, and so we were kind of on this same path as young rising political stars. I think over time, my beliefs on the system have gone a different direction than hers. But my love for her has increased at the same time. The challenge then becomes, does the politics in our, like, for most people, it wouldn't be an issue, right? Because they're not, you could talk to your wife and it wouldn't be, but I don't know, let me back up. So I feel like, no, my political opinions are not the same as my wife's. But because I have such a dominant presence, people try to make her opinions my opinions. Do you think that people think because you're Charles Thomas that you shape your wife's opinions?
Yeah, they think that, but it's just the opposite. She has shaped mine, and because I see her as being more real. Because I'm sitting there in a bubble, in a silo too much, thinking about politics all the time. When politics are not all what life is about.
Right.
And she reminds me of that every day.
The her and Fruity Pebbles.
And Cocoa Bubbles. They Bubbles. Remind me that life is more than politics. And I know I'm consumed by it, but she's a constant reminder of that. That it's more about loving her and loving Cocoa Bubbles and, you know, my family and my kids and all that. That's the most important thing.
Yeah, so WVON audience, give us a call, 773-591-1690. Do you share the same political beliefs as your spouse? Women, does your husband tell you what to think in a polling place? Do you vote the same as your husband? Like, Charles, do you think you and your wife vote the same?
No.
No?
Because sometimes I hang on to my old ways. She does her thing. It reminds me that most people, because I, you know, when we lose an election, or my candidate loses and hers wins, does that happen often? Maybe not as often as it could.
Yeah, I'm curious to know because, you know, I always think people are, you know, when you see a family, you look at the family and you think, like, are you the head of your household? And as the head of the household, do you impose your political will? Do you influence your family? Do you tell your family what to think? Yeah.
No. Absolutely not.
No?
No, if I do, it ain't working.
That's it. So why do you think that the perception, because I still think that the perception is the man makes the decisions in the house. Do you think that?
Not anymore. Why would that be? I mean, you know, I think in black households, 72% are headed by women. Is that right?
Huh.
Isn't that the deal?
That is the deal.
Right.
See, I don't think that my wife and I agree on about 70% of the things.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, I think that politically, I think that I've taken a tack that it's kind of like I want to do something different. And some people feel like they fight in the system. Some people feel like they fight outside of the system. I just am curious. Let's go to the phone lines. Mike, do you and your wife share the same political views? Do you make your wife vote the way you want her to vote?
Hey, baby. I don't make my wife do a damn thing.
Me either.
we are politically alike. We're two peas in a pod politically. But we agree on most things. Hey, but for the more pertinent issue, Angela Ryan's fine as hell, bro.
I got nothing
but respect for comedy.
Look, he said, Mike, you said Angela Rye would wake your eyes up too, huh? Because come on, man, Common said that, bro. He said he became more politically aware because he of who he was dating. And I'm saying, man, Common, with all the stuff going on in Chicago, it took Angela Rye.
Hey, man, that sounds like game.
Uh-oh.
He wants that to be hers. That sounds like game.
Oh, my God.
What she got to do with Chicago? She's not even from Chicago.
Right.
She's not even from Chicago. What could she possibly be telling him about whatever to make him think more about what's happening in Chicago?
She probably talking about Donald Trump talking about Chicago, and he was like, oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Is that what you want me to think about, baby?
Yeah.
Just come right over here, sit right here. I think whatever you want me to think. I cannot believe Charles Thomas just went here with this Angela rap.
No, I'm just saying.
I know.
I didn't go in on anything.
Huh?
What did I do?
Huh?
I just said that she. That, well, you know, Common had, you know, they listed all these women that Common has dated. Taraji P. What's her last name? Woman MC. On Empire.
Taraji P. MC.
Right. Serena Williams. Badu. I mean, man, he has had quite a few.
How come none of them made like him a, think politically?
He's like a certified woman catcher or whatever.
See, man, I'm telling you. So, ladies and gentlemen, give us a call. 773-591-1690. Do you share the same political... share the same political opinions as your spouse? You know, I think that... do you think that in the suburbs, white women vote the same as their Republican husbands? Right? Do
they,
issues...
They say they don't.
Do the issues... Like, I guess I wonder, are the issues the same for men and for women in Chicago? Do black folk... Does the black man influence his wife's vote?
You know, I think that, again, I go back to that other statistic. A lot of black men are not in the house every day with the woman to influence the vote. Right?
Hmm.
I mean, so it's a different situation when you talk about influence.
I don't know. I wonder, has the role of the man in the house changed completely? Like, is the man still even the head of the household?
No, not as much.
The
as
man he, is not the head
not
of the house.
Not as much as he was 50 years ago. Certainly not. No.
Good or bad?
Good or bad?
Hold it. We'll answer that question when we come back later. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the WVON Morning Show. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Charles Thomas will be back. Social media question of the day. Do you share the same political beliefs as your spouse? Plus, coming up, Cook County Board President candidate. Bob Fioretti. He'll be here at 7 o'clock. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Talk of Chicago, 647.
More of the Morning Show with Maze Jackson coming up on the Talk of Chicago.
Go ahead, Charles. Charles?
Now, what do I think? I mean, I don't think that men are definitely not. I mean, they talk about black women now being the most educated subgroup, so to speak, in America. How are they going to be the most educated group in America getting the information from the least educated group in America? If you want to talk about black men, right? Black women are certainly smarter than that. I mean, they're going to be making a lot of their own decisions. Is that good? No, not good. Not good. Particularly the difference between black women and black men. That's not good. There's got to be more balance in the game, but it's not there. And a lot of that has to do with what society is doing to black men. But I certainly don't think that black women are taking their political direction from black men or any other direction on finance, how to raise the children, other issues that might come up. Because there's so much balance that's happened to black men. So many horrible things have happened to black men over the years. I mean, and we're speaking only in generalities here, believe me. Specific cases, you know, I can't address that. But in generalities, if you look at the general statistics, that most children are being raised in single-parent homes, 72%, I think. No. Those black women, why would they take direction from black men? No, I don't see that. No. I'm not saying there are no educated brothers left. I'm talking about general statistics. I mean, they're just absolutely not. There are educated brothers out there. There are brothers out there who are husbands, you know, and living in the same household. But that's a minority these days. And I don't know if it was, I don't know when it was, last time it was a majority, but I know it's a majority these days. And those, and educated black women being the most educated segment of American society right now. That's true. Black women, more so than white women, more so than Asian women, more so than Latino women. Black women, they're not taking, getting their political marching orders from black men. No, why would they? You know, black women are the, when we talk about politics and who the candidates try to appeal to, black women. Black women. Black women are a formidable force at the polling place. Formidable. And if you're a candidate and you're trying to reach black people, you go through black women. Now, maybe 50 years ago, you went through black men. But now you got to go through black women. Maze Jackson, is that true?
Yeah. I would say that if you want the most loyal group of voters is going to be black women, right? And that does speak to the fact that the black man is no longer in the household, a whole bunch of other stuff. But yeah, I would tell you that the black women is the way. They used to go, I think Jacob Israel hit it too. It's either black women, but they get the black women through the church a lot of times is their process. Hey, Carrie! That's my candy girl! Candy girl! You're a special treat, candy girl. I want to say, I know what I mean. When I'm with you, it feels so good, chew it through. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago 1698. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. Charles, hey man, I'm in a mode, bro. Let's sit down. Dedicated candy girl to my beautiful wife, Commissioner Steele.
Oh, really? Oh, that's what that was? I thought that was a Tony Preckwinkle campaign song.
Candy girl. Candy girl.
Hey, congratulations on your second episode.
Hey man, thank
you. I'm sorry I got that.
You got that, you know.
We got Fioretti coming in here, and I was thinking that's what that was.
We got Fioretti. Oh, you know what, Charles? I think we got some double entendres going on around
here. Yeah, I'm sorry, man. I got to get back in the game.
Hey, man.
Hey, happy anniversary.
Thank you, my brother. Okay. You know what? But wish Commissioner Carey Steele a happy anniversary, because, Charles, you know what? This show right here gives me in a lot of trouble, man. This show right here.
Oh, me too.
Hey, you know what?
I gotta go home and say, hey, baby, look, it's only a show.
Right, you gotta say, baby.
It's a show. It's not.
Well, Charles,
not
see.
Not real? Did I
say that? Well, it is real. So, Charles, I gotta go home and do the same thing and say, baby, it's only a show. And then she says, that ain't what Pat Dowell or Tony Preckwinkle was calling people saying. So, I just wanna know, Charles, social media question of the day. Do you share the political beliefs of your spouse or significant other? My man Common said, Angela Rye has awakened him to the she has made him more politically aware. You think she's standing in front of the TV like she's standing in front of CNN and be like, you look at the TV. Charles, this, I guess the thing that I try to get to is, have we moved to a point where black women do not rely on black men to make their political decisions for them?
Yes.
Dang, man, no elaboration?
I don't have to elaborate.
you mean this ain't 19? You don't think this that the black man tells his bro. Woman, this is how you vote? This is what we...
No. He doesn't tell her how to spend the money anymore because she's making more money than him. She can't take... What can he say to her? Again, she is the most educated subgroup in American society. That's what I heard here on the WVON morning show several weeks ago, a couple of months ago, and it was documented. No way are you gonna, we going to tell her what to do. Not now.
So, Charles, why do you think that there is the perception in some cases? You know what I can't say in some cases. I don't understand how the independent black women still also hold women accountable for the decisions of their husbands.
Say that again?
Yeah, I said, so then why do black women still hold other black women accountable for the decisions of their husbands?
What husbands?
Like me.
Well, yeah, but I mean, you're not the majority. I mean, you're not majority anymore. I mean, so what are they really talking about? I don't understand that they're even doing that.
Man, Charles, it just seems like, I don't know, can a dominant man and a dominant woman exist in the same space politically?
Yes, they can.
Black?
Black, white, Asian.
You think? Latino.
Yeah, you can do that in the United States. Yeah, definitely.
What about in Cook County? You talking about United States.
Taliban, you can't do that. You can't do that in Afghanistan.
You can't do that in Madaganistan in some cases. In some cases. Right? Or Pakistan. Pakistan, they'd be like, oh, no. You can't. I guess, Charles, you know, my biggest thing is, and the reason I brought up this, you know, Angela Rye made Common more politically aware. And there was this, you know, it just brought to me, can two powerful people exist with different opinions, still love each other, and agree to disagree on tactics? And I'm really personalizing this because it really is something that I go through on a daily basis.
Two black folks, I know that this...
Two black folks from Cook County.
Two black folks from Cook County. I think you're going to find more of that moving forward. Definitely. You're going to find more of that, particularly next year. You're going to find that all over the place because, man, black folks are looking. We are set adrift. We are set adrift politically. We don't have a political home in either party. And I think people are going to be picking and choosing and keeping their powder dry when they have to keep it dry, firing off when they have to. I'm seriously, I think we're going to see change now. I mean, this post-Obama thing is huge. I keep talking about that all the time. We have to change the paradigm.
Let me go to the phones. Let's go to T. You're on the top of Chicago.
Hey, what's going on, man?
What's up, T? T, do me a favor. Tell Carrie happy anniversary, man.
Hey, happy anniversary to you.
All right, go ahead, brother.
And many more. You know, I'm one that opted out. You know, I was married, and I hope to again one day. But I enjoy too much being single. So here's my take on the thing, because I think basically we are separated in so many ways from the black community, politically, economically, and when I hear the most educated, I don't see no black businesses. I don't see nothing of substance. Most of these degrees are not STEM cell or things that can change the black community. So basically a lot of these women are single. And I think basically, I mean, we have preponderance. Let's do the facts. I mean, let's go with the facts. 70% unmarried.
Woo, T, you touching on some nerves, man. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the WVON Morning Show. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas. Social media question of the day. Do you have the same political beliefs as your spouse or significant other? Now, when we come back, candidate for Cook County Board President Bob Fioretti in the building. Charles, questions. The Lions, wake them up. It's time to get started.
The talk of Chicago and the voice of the nation. 1690 WVON, Irwin, Chicago.
What's up, y'all? Thank you for indulging me shortly. I'm sorry. What's going on? Okay. What up, Kang? What up, Nanette? What up, Tamiko? What up, Sheila? What up, Sharon? What up, Carl Miller? What up, Yolanda? Hey, I'm sending a big apology to Tamiko yesterday. Tamiko, my phone was on Do Not Disturb, but I was at the office. I was rehearsing. I just expected you to pop up like you always do. So I apologize. That's cool. So, Tamiko, I'm sorry. That's Tamiko Ho. What up, Renee Scott? What up, Daryl Stiff? What up, Briscoe? Hey, y'all, could y'all do me a favor? Again, if you have not, take a moment. Send Commissioner Kerry Steele a happy anniversary. If you can't leave it on a page, send her a tweet. Now, I would ask y'all to tweet the Cook County Board President and tell her to leave Commissioner Steele alone, but I might get in trouble for that. But if y'all decide y'all want to do that on y'all own, I ain't got nothing to do with that. What up, Nafisa? What up, Nafisa Simmons Worldwide? Hey, man, I'm still trying to get some. Can I be on your, can I? Let me stop. What up, Nafisa? How you doing? Long time no see. What up, Carl Miller? What up, Daryl Stiff? What up, Kang? What up, Kit? Look, y'all. Man trying to do his job. Like, see? Like, he different. It's back. Look, now he like, don't tell me what to do. Look, he like, now Bob ain't gonna get no seat.
We'll give Bob the good chair. He gets a special chair today.
Oh! Bob! Look, check that out, y'all. You heard that? Bob's getting the white guy chair.
Right here?
Look, the brothers... Oh, Big Otis coming here. He got to sit in the kid chair. Ty got the special chair for Bob Fioretti. See how they do each other? See how these white people do? They all cousins some kind of way. Right? Fioretti, Ronskowski, they got an eye in the back. They all related. Hey, y'all. So, guys, help me out, Den. How do I make sure that we can keep fighting without them trying to put the foo fops on my wife? Help a brother out. What can I do? Help me, help me, help me. Y'all know this is stressful sometimes. Uh-oh, there he goes, y'all. Uh-oh.
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh. There is Bob Fioretti. That is right there as the Lions did. Right in the place.
I'm looking good, man. I'm feeling good.
Last time I saw you, man, you gained a few pounds.
No, you know.
Anyway, in the meantime, y'all, I need y'all to help me.
I couldn't eat, and so, you know, gradually
stand up, make them know that we ain't, man. Kerry got some back.
Except, you know, my neck was at 18.
Can y'all help a brother out? What y'all think we need to do? This is the only day I get to talk about it, because I ain't going to talk about it no other day. So help a brother out, right?
So you were with my good friend yesterday, Dr. Wilson.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
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 We're gonna have fun,
you know. Oh, Nate, I know it's part of the game, but we can push back. And I know, Tamiko, but we gotta push. I want them to know.
You know, we're on Facebook. I gotta watch my language.
So we're on Facebook and YouTube Live.
Wait a minute. Since when are you watching?
We have to be cool when we in the, even in the breaks.
Yeah. Okay.
So just remember. The camera don't go off even on the breaks. That's all we said. So whatever you talk about, there's a lot of campaign commercials made right off of these cameras right here. There's going to be some winners and some losers. I just need to get the...
Can I talk from way down here?
Hey, it's our... Yep. Congratulations. Dang, how Facebook...
I don't know, man. I'm we're just getting, everybody's getting gearing up for the campaign, man. Next year, there's gonna be a lot going on. And, you know, this place is coming back to life, which we, which we're really excited about that.
Yeah.
And because now we have somewhere to like talk about issues in a way
that's right.
I mean, some of the things that have gone on here, I think, has been more. They just do the party establishments. I'll just party.
Exactly.
We don't do that.
Oh, I know. Yeah, I know. I listen to you guys almost every morning.
Was that right?
Yeah.
A lot of people do, you know?
Yeah.
A lot of people do. They just aren't.
They just don't tell nobody.
They just don't tell nobody. Because we kind of.
In fact, you know, I think my wife listens in the morning too, talking about strong women, and then she. On the L, she listens to something else, and then as she walks to work, gets back to you guys, so.
I'm telling you, people tell us that they, the funniest thing is people talking to us about the struggle that they go through in the mornings, trying to keep up with the show. So they talk about how they watch it on Facebook Live. They got it on their iPhone, their iPad. Oh. They got something for this room. Right. They got something when they go in the bathroom. Then they got to turn it on their thing so they can turn it up so they can hear it while they're getting dressed. Then they go to their car. The people, the struggles that people have to keep up with the show on multiple platforms is hilarious.
Yeah. And this Facebook thing is amazing. I mean, we did this Facebook Live yesterday too. And I was surprised at the number of people that jumped into it to watch it. It was under 100, but I saw a number at 78, 79, but I think there may have been a couple other hits that hit it.
It's, but you don't,
that you don't always see who's
right.
Everybody.
But here's the thing. The thing that I try to help people understand with Facebook and social is that it's not the initial view. People now are accustomed to watching their TV or their programming when they want to watch it.
Right.
So it's not the initial views that you get. It is like we do probably 50% more views after we get off. People coming home, going back to watch it.
Yes.
And then when you look at the reach, like yesterday's show reached about 40,000 people just on social that they can verify. Right. So like, and then the show we did on Monday reached 65,000 people. That's just social. That is not broadcast, and that's all quantifiable. So the thing with social is that you, when Arbitron tells you, or Nielsen tells you, you got these ratings, that's based on them hoping somebody's recorded or something along those lines. This is actual verifiable because they can show it to you. So I always tell people, you got extra legs. If you win here, you can win here, but you can also, I've seen many a campaign lose from a digital. Ask Jacob Meister. Let's go. Hey! Oh, there it goes. We're at 124 right now.
Oh, is that? It's too loud.
I got what you want. You got what I want.
Tell me where you are.
Is this it?
Forever mine. Ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. But you know how we do at the top of the hour. Gotta say what's up to the WVON morning show team. Good morning to Miss Annette Flournoy in the newsroom, as well as the musical director of the Soul Plane, Miss Sonia Escobar. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, you know these songs dedicated would challenge her in this race. But now, Charles, live in the studio, Bob Fioretti. Talk to us. Break it down.
Bob Fioretti, welcome to the WVON Morning Show. We call this the Lion's Den. We focus on issues important to the black community.
Black.
That's what we do here. Black. And you announced yesterday that you're going to challenge Cook County Board President Tony Preckwinkle in the March primary as a Democrat.
A black woman Democrat.
That's correct.
Tell us about it. I mean, why did you make that decision to go when so many others, including Commissioner Richard Boykin, said they wouldn't do it? You say you will.
I love this county. I love the city. I grew up on the South Side. I was born in Roseland Hospital, went to Mendel High School. And I look at things that happened here, and I look at what's happening to our people of our county, whether they're on the south side, south suburbs, west side, west suburbs. They're being taxed out. Everybody's being taxed out of here. And I see wrong decisions being made. You know, they make all these threats at the last moment, and what the threats are, well, we're going to lay off people, when they haven't really looked at the budget and taking the budget. The first reaction from a lot of the Democrats for the last 8 years has been, let's tax the people. When the current president came in, she ran on let's repeal the 1 cent sales tax. Now, she did that for a year, and then it came back. You know, these are the kind of decisions that they've rushed in. I'm going to make collective decisions for the people of our county and make it together and stay true to the mission of what county government is. And county government's about good public health and public safety for all of the citizens of this county.
Ah, I hear you say that, all citizens, Bob. But this whole thing, when we look at the South Suburbs, we look at the fact that it's not all citizens that are being disproportionately affected in a negative way. We are seeing South and West suburbs. What are you gonna do specifically to help Black folks?
Well, I think, first of all, I think we gotta look at what's happening on the South and West suburbs. The South suburbs and the South Side, they're all almost one. They've been hit hard by the recession and they haven't recovered. We were in Lansing to demonstrate the problem yesterday about high taxes and the impact on the people as they're moving out. High property taxes, people are moving out. The foreclosure crisis that hasn't ended to the people of the citizens of the South Suburbs. Look at the Tribune did an expose on the water bill. Two big articles. When I say that, I think they occupied about three pages of the Tribune twice. And it's the southern suburbs and the western suburbs where Black citizens, poor, underfunded, are getting hit hardest with the water bills.
Let me back up. I hear you telling us, we all know about the problems, but talk to me about the solutions. And I also want to just say this real quick. All Black people are not poor. So
that's correct.
Continue.
That's correct. Now, and so we can't lump everybody together, but the impact in certain areas are impacting Black citizens especially. And I think what we need to do is increase the amount of jobs and job training. There is no excuse that people can't have jobs in this county, in this city. We are overextending in terms of what happens, a budget, that we can find ways to give job training, good education, public safety for our citizens.
But if you don't tax people to raise the revenue you need to run the government, what do you do? How do you get the revenue without taxing homeowners and consumers?
Well, what has happened, the knee-jerk reaction of the county board has been to always tax.
Yeah, we know that. Well, but, so what are you going to do if you don't
tax?
We
can cut budget. We have to look at the budget, and we got to get rid of the a lot of the political patronage that is there. I mean, Richard Boykin, as you said his name, he came up with seven items on where we can save and not lay off on this budget. Eliminate the 1,500 vacancies. Right side some of the departments. Get rid of the duplicity that we have. Get rid of, and I think in his recommendation said a lot of the middle management, but those are all the political patronage hirees that he was talking
about. Can you vow not to increase any tax if you're elected county board president? Will you make that vow?
Well, I'm not going to go all the way and say that, but my answer is I don't think in the next 4 years when I'm Cook County president that I will raise taxes.
That you
and
will raise taxes? You say you won't.
I won't. And I say that absent any catastrophe in terms of what the federal government will do or what may happen that is a catastrophic. If I have to raise taxes, I'm going to come back to the people of this county and go door to door throughout all sections of it. But there is no need to raise taxes under this budget as it is even currently crafted. And the layoffs keep coming as threats to the people and to the county workers, and that has to stop because everybody's shaking in their boots saying, am I going to be laid off? There are ways to deal with the situation.
Bob, what do you say to Black people that say if you're elected, Black folks will be eliminated from the power structure in the state of Illinois?
Well, I think anybody that knows me, I was elected alderman of the second ward, the most diverse ward in the city of Chicago at that time. It was 76% African American. I served the needs of all of the people of that ward. I went out. I fought for not closing the schools, which is the beginning of the destruction of a lot of our communities when they close the schools. To me, that was strategic gentrification. As an approach, and I think the people of my ward can testify, whether you're in Bronzeville or you're on the far west side, that they will never, their voices will be heard.
Bob, but as a follow-up to that, in response to all of that, they took the second ward away from the black community. Yeah, so how sure does that did. Help out for us? How can you help them?
Well, they sure did, because, you know, I think the power structure always wants to maintain power. And they don't want somebody that's going to speak out against it. And it was a prime time during the remap that they were able to take the second ward and move it up to the far north side. I wasn't going to move my house. My house was not in the second ward, but my house in the new second ward, the remapped ward. That's the way the political insiders operate here. And we've got to put an end to that. We need to start listening to what the people of this county want. And we can do it in such a way that we can represent all of the people.
You know, I'm looking here on our Facebook comment, and I see Salim Mumakil, one of our hosts here at WVON. He wants to know what your position is on a financial transactions tax that might be imposed by Cook County to create revenue or generate revenue that would help run the hospital and the public safety system.
Well, first of all, again, I don't think we need to increase or put impose new taxes under this budget if we make the right kind of surgical cuts.
What about future budgets moving forward?
And I think we can come up with a good foundation for the next 4 years under my leadership, because I think the leadership is not doing the knee-jerk reaction of let's have more taxes. But I've addressed this in the past. I was for the financial transaction tax. But we have to go to Springfield, number one, change the law in Springfield. Number two, the issue is much broader. And I think we're almost fooling ourselves because it's really got to be done in Washington.
We got to stop you right there.
So you oppose it?
No. I'm in favor of it. I have
to. Just talk to the mic. You're in favor of the
financial
transaction. But you won't work for one.
If it comes forward and we can do it on both the national and state level, I'm in favor.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned into the Talk Chicago, 1690 AM. We're talking to candidate for Cook County Board President Bob Fioretti. We'll be back at 7:17 after traffic and weather.
More of the morning show with Mays Jackson.
Okay,
coming up.
So here's the deal. We got a bank full of calls.
Financial transactions.
You know, I was talking. Right? I was finishing up a statement. I was talking.
Oh, I'm sorry, I was on my
no worries. Right. So, we're going to take these. We're going to take questions. We're going to take calls, live calls as well. But you should also be aware that I'm sure that Tony's got people calling as well.
Oh, sure.
All right, Charles, you can go ahead.
I know.
Yeah, you know, I this whole thing with DNA info and how the Ricketts guy, the billionaire guy.
Right.
He just pulled the plug on it. Just pulled the plug.
Right.
Hit a kill switch, mm-hmm. and it was gone.
Right.
He couldn't have done that to a newspaper.
Right.
To that had physical plant and printers mm-hmm. and everything. He couldn't have done it.
Right.
You can't pull the plug on a factory like that. Mm-hmm. You gotta.
All right. You gotta give notice. You gotta.
Right. You gotta do stuff.
Yes.
Financial transaction tax. These people. You know, I think that Ricketts thing demonstrated
that they
pulled
the
plug and moved to Indianapolis. See, like that, man.
Not only that.
You know, that was an object lesson.
To Atlanta. And I'll tell you, I sat with the board as alderman. I don't know how many when I say the board, there were 10, 12 of them that were members of the board. I was convinced at that time that they could have moved to on the Hudson River. They had a massive potential place. I think they've sold since then, or Atlanta. I am worried. There's nobody in the building anymore. You do every, and I said it in 06 that a time will come that they don't even have to get out of bed and they'll do their trades.
In fact, there's this whole business of the guys on the trading floor with the blue badges. Yeah, man, they do that for show. They don't need to do that anymore.
There's one pit left. Yeah,
there's one pit. Maybe one pit left. Right. That's the last time.
Right.
That was several years ago.
Right.
That I checked that. But I tell you,
that building is less than, from what I understand, less than 50% occupied at this point.
What, the Merck?
The Merck.
And I tell you,
you walk around the restaurants that are there on Van Buren next to it, and the guys tell me how much their clientele has dropped off. They don't have it anymore.
We're talking about financial transaction tax and the fact that, as Ricketts demonstrated, you pull the plug on a internet kind of or high-tech business like trading is now, you've leave. You go.
Right.
See, you go.
And the thing has to be done. Granted, they, I think it was in 1983 that they put an amendment into the state statute that says you cannot have a financial transaction tax. Now, we're talking 1983, okay? And it may have been 82, right in that area. Now, it has to be done on a federal level if we're going to have a fight.
Yeah, because the other thing, too, is that the trade itself, even though the guy might be sitting in Chicago, it might be the origin of it might be in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, they could just say where it's origin, where the origin is. It's deep, man.
And tracking it down from this thing nowadays is almost near impossible.
But you know, in general, these high tech companies with their in-house gyms and cafeterias and free beer on Friday and all this good stuff, they talk about how wonderful they are. You let the wrong person take control of one of these companies. Your Facebook or your YouTube or your whatever, this could be some of the most repressive stuff that could happen, man. Right. These owners of these companies could do stuff that would just blow your mind away if they wanted to. Because they're not regulated.
Yeah.
I'm so glad, so happy. Do you know that you're still mine?
This is to you, baby.
Together, we share all the hearts.
You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. And we are talking to candidate for Cook County Board President, Bob Fioretti, who just announced yesterday that he was running for Cook County Board President. Did we get to the end of his last question? Well, go ahead, Charles.
You know, I wanted to shift gears a little bit because you ran for mayor in 2015, and then you dropped out of the race at the very last, near the end of it, and you shifted your support to Rahm Emanuel. How do you think Rahm's doing this second term? Particularly after the Laquan McDonald situation.
Well, first of all, if anybody ever listened
to talking to the mic.
If anybody ever listened to what my endorsement was, it was on a very limited, one single issue about the financial structure and the financial future of this city. I had three interviews with both of the candidates at the time, and I think Rahm had a better understanding of the financial future.
Why would you say that? I mean, what led you to believe that? A lot of people think that was only because he was white and Chewy was Latino.
Well, that was a crazy. I mean, when you sit through and you have about 3-hour discussions with individuals, you get to see if their understanding of the issues, understanding of how they were going to approach it. I still, at that time, a couple of years ago, the financial structure of this city was still in disarray from what was happening. I think there were issues that I limited to only.
And think he's done a pretty good job since then?
No, I don't, because I'm going to go back. I think if you put three options on the table, I've seen this administration choose the wrong option. They keep kicking the can down the road. We need to get a firmer grasp on terms of what we are doing and affecting our citizens. I mean, you know, they talk about this Amazon. We're giving away $2.25 billion for what? I don't see the benefits in our communities. I don't see the job training in our communities. And they name 10 sites. Preckwinkle, Rahm, and Rauner put together a proposal that's going to give all this money to one of the most largest companies in the world, and we've got to be shaking our head. If they've got that, they can be giving it to our schools.
So, Bob, Rahm supported you. I mean, you supported Rahm in the last election. Will he support you in this one?
No, I don't know. I haven't asked him. And
will you seek his support?
I'm going to ask for everybody's support. I doubt if
Will you ask Speaker Michael Madigan for his support?
I think
he
the
is
power
the chairman.
I have always been against the insiders, and the insiders haven't been for me. And I have taken on the insiders all the time. And we've gotten structural changes because of some of the progressive, positive legislation that I proposed.
So will you ask for the support of Cook County Chairman of the Cook County Board,
No.
Joe Berrios?
No.
Will he? You won't support? Are you supporting? Do you think Joe Barrios has been doing a good job?
No. I mean, let's face facts. I mean, the tag. Where have the? When I first ran against the establishment, I said this tax structure that we have is unfair. The insiders benefit from this tax structure. I said it in 06. I kept saying it throughout my term of what it's happening. Why do we have to appeal every time we get our taxes? It's ludicrous, if not ridiculous. People shouldn't have to be suffering. It's instituted. I said it a long time ago before the report came out in May that the tax structure was institutional racism.
Have you chosen a candidate to support against Joe Barrios' reelection?
I'm talking to the candidates, and we're going to see where we go.
Hey, Bob, how do you feel the Democratic Party has done by the black community?
I think the Democratic Party in this state has abandoned whatever principles they have. It's all about, it's not about helping others. It's not about pulling up people and leveling the playing field. It's about putting money in their own pockets. The power structure here has been here too long.
You got a horse in the governor's race?
Not yet. I am talking to all of them. I think, I've had a number of discussions with each of the candidates. But it's what are they going to do for the people of this state? What are they going to do for the people of the city? I mean, South, I went down to Carbondale in August, actually for the eclipse. But instead of taking the highway, we took the side roads to see what it was like. Beyond south of I-80, you think you're on the west or south sides of the city of Chicago. It's complete devastation in terms of what's happening. Communities are devastated. Our university structures, because of what happened with the budget crisis, is the same. Eastern, Western, Southern, people aren't coming to it. Even U of I is suffering at this point.
Bob, tell me a politician that is currently elected that is doing a good job, and then I want you to take it a step further and point to a black politician who you think is doing a good job. General and then black.
In this state?
In this state, right now, currently. A good job.
I'm thinking, and I see some of the state senators.
Give me one.
I'm gonna have to think about that.
Whoa.
Give me a black somebody that's doing a good job.
I'm gonna have to think about that. You know, I see some of them that are on some specific issues like housing and what we need to do on housing.
Who? Give me a name. Throw somebody out here. Who's doing a good job? Just give me somebody.
Well, the problem is, I think most of our politicians have been in office way too long, and they've gotten comfortable in the positions, and it has led to the leadership to allow a bill to go through here or there, and then everybody can pound their chest and say, "Oh, look what we did! Well, it was just window dressing."
Are you talking about those daggone political mailers? These bills that get passed for political mailers. Look, man, Bob, my question for you is, how do you win? What is your path to victory in your mind?
And I think my path is to go out to every community.
Oh, so...
And every community, and talk about the issues, listen to the people. And even after I'm elected, I'm going to continue going out to the communities.
So will you be trying to seek Republican crossover votes?
Well, I think my ideas may appeal across the board. I mean, we have
but
to
will you campaign in places that were predominantly or traditionally Republican?
I'm looking for the Democratic vote, and I want the Democratic vote. This is a Democratic primary. If somebody crosses, I don't think there's going to be that many crossovers. Let me tell you that the Republican primary now has a very conservative gubernatorial candidate who will be out there, and I don't see any of the people crossing over into the Democratic primary. So we have to just go for Democratic votes, and that's my aim and only my aim.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are talking to candidate for Cook County Board President, Bob Fioretti. You know what, Bob? I want to know if when you get back, do you think that your entry to this race will make Tony Preckwinkle nicer or nastier? We'll ask that question when we come back.
Live.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the WVON Morning Show. Let's see. Do you have questions? Do you guys have questions that you want us to ask off camera? We can ask them right now. Bob, I'm going to take some questions from Facebook Live. If you want to, if you can take those and get some
responses. You know, that's a tough question. Who's doing a good job? you think about it. It's a very difficult question. Yeah, I mean, I don't know that I can answer it at this point. Who's in office?
So,
a good job.
Bob.
And I think the leadership controls and allows the mailers to go through to say that they, I mean, the tougher legislation has always been blocked. And so sometimes the you know, the rep or the senator says, oh, and they can beat their chest. I tried. Look at, I introduced it. I always have to laugh. Who was it? Will Gazzardi. He said, on the night that he won the primary against Tony Berrios, he said, oh, my first vote's going to be against Mike Madigan. And sure enough, when he got there, his first vote was for Mike Madigan.
That's right. You know, they coordinate. The Senate gets minimum wage, right? They get to vote for minimum wage increase. But the House, it never comes up because this was, I'm talking the 20th last time around, because they want to give the senators a chance to do a mailer on minimum wage. But the House will do some other
hot
button issue. Yeah,
gun
whatever.
They'll get
to do their mailers on that.
Right.
And they know what they're doing. I mean, they have a color, gender, Madigan have a meeting and they decide, well, you do this. And you get for you your mailer, and I'll do this for my mailer. But nothing happens because the other house, the other chamber, isn't going to deal with it. It's amazing what they do down there. I call it the Springfield one step.
Right.
It's a dance.
That's all it is.
It's a dance, and they do it constantly to do mailers.
Right.
Bob, so just we got people who say that you came on this show and you don't know any black politicians. Do you know the names of any black politicians? I want you to. So are there any black politicians that you've worked with in the past?
I've worked with a whole slew of them.
Give me some names.
Maddie Hunter, Jackie Collins, you know, from, and all the black caucus in the city council. I mean, that's ridiculous to say I don't know any black politicians.
Okay,
you want me to?
No.
Call them up right now.
I don't think that's the case. I think that what we want to do is just make sure that people are clear that you do know.
Right.
You just couldn't think of who's
doing
good.
I worked with Ricky Hendon a number of times. Okay, and I'll tell you, you know why? Because I worked with my house, and because how diverse my district was, I had 7 reps and 3 state senators that I was working with all the time. And I was able to get things done in my ward that nobody else ever did. I created 8,000 jobs in my ward. I brought a Costco, a Target, a Pete's. I closed the food desert. I'm the only alderman that ever closed the food desert. When you talk about jobs,
next door to that Pete's.
You know, 8,000 jobs I brought in. And I had community benefit agreements, or I talked to the people that the Target, the Costco, to hire from our neighborhoods.
And so, Bob, why'd you lose for Senate?
Because when the Republicans and the Democrats don't want an independent voice and they back a candidate, that's what happens.
What Republicans back?
They threw money into that, into my challenge race.
Okay.
That was as simple as that. From day one, they were supporting her.
Bob, how were you able to win the second ward initially? Like, how did you put that coalition together?
There were 11,400 doors that I could knock on, and I'm not talking about the high rises, and I went to each one of them over and over and over again. I also had some significant victories in terms of Alfonso Rollins, who was wrongly convicted, and we helped get him out, have a huge settlement on him. That people knew in the community.
Were you on the Aaron Patterson thing too?
No.
Okay.
No.
So you got somebody on death row?
The baby Tamia case.
Oh, wait.
The baby Tamia case that, you know, that every black
lawyer
did not want to deal with. And I remember when Mary Mitchell at the press conference said, well, I talked to every black adoption lawyer in the city, and they said, you're never going to get that baby back. And I said, yes, we will.
And within 90 days, 120 days, not only did we get the baby back from Utah, we changed the law.
So we might give you an opportunity to talk about that, then we'll take some questions too from the phones. We got phones. Oh my goodness. Bob, what's your reception been like out in the streets?
I think it's been great. I mean, it's been nonstop.
What's your signature count looking like? Will you turn in the double, or will you just turn in the... How many think you're going to turn in?
I think we have about 14,000.
Now? Currently?
Currently.
Okay.
See, when people approach me, they ask me to run, and I put a couple of requirements. Among them was...
Who asked you to run?
Just citizens, and they wanted to get some things together. I authorized in mid-October, I said, get me 6,000 signatures by the October 31st. They came in, they had about 8,000 at that time. There are about maybe 80 people out there circulating throughout parts of the county right now.
Okay. Have you seen reception to your petition? I've heard a lot of people pushing back from signing petitions.
They keep saying, from what I understand, I have not signed a petition until yesterday, and I haven't even circulated a petition. I did receive a email from or a text from somebody about a week ago that if you really want to see what this campaign's about, start circulating your own petitions, because, and it was somebody in down in Bronzeville, and he said he was amazed at the reception.
Okay, come back. Hey, that's for my wifey. I got a wifey. It's our anniversary.
By the way, happy anniversary there.
Huh?
Happy anniversary.
Thank you. You can tell her. You're my wifey. Complete. You're my wife. Ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the Talk Chicago 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. And we are talking to Cook County Board candidate Bob Fioretti. Bob, talk to me about your black... You were telling us some story about your history in the black community. Why should black people care about you?
Well, I care about them. I care about making sure everybody in this city has a job, has a good education, has the opportunity to exceed and excel. I find it incredible on what has happened. And you know, I grew up in Roseland. I went to my I go down to Roseland once a month, once every 6 weeks.
Don't see very many white people down there, do
you? No, you don't. But I go back.
They're moving
it,
back.
And I see what happens in the community. I see the continuing deterioration of the community. We can throw a few pieces out there and say, oh yeah, we did this and this, but the truth of the matter is we don't have the right kind of support structure in place. We don't have education there. When you close 50 schools, that's one of the first ways to get rid of a community, by closing the schools, especially the community schools in communities.
But despite that fact, you did shift your support to Rahm Emanuel.
Well, on the sole economic issue about survival. That was it.
That was bigger than the school issue.
It was, because I don't think the city would be here today.
Let's talk about the county and contracting. What are you going to do to increase the number of black contractors who do business with Cook County?
Well, first of all, I have been informed by some of the commissioners as of recent that the numbers are exceedingly low. So low, I mean, I think we're in single digits.
Under 2%, I believe.
So,
it's
unacceptable.
What are you going to do?
I mean, we are purposefully and intentionally going to raise that number.
You're going to set a goal.
And yes.
What is that goal?
Probably in the 20s, if not higher.
Really?
I mean, we have to change it. We got to bring jobs into our communities. When we gave money to Rush. I was not completely aware, and when I came in to office, I had two or three of the aldermen in the area that was opposed to giving Rush help. There were 500 jobs in the that I got from Rush to give to our community, and people were able to walk to work, have good paying, high paying jobs, and that's what we need to continue for, no matter where. And the same thing in our communities, to make sure that they can have good high paying jobs under these contracts.
Bob, let's go to the phone line. Sam, you're on the Talk of Chicago. You're talking to Bob Fioretti.
Hey, Bob. Hey, Maze.
What's up, Sam?
Hi, how are you?
All right.
Hey, my name is Sam, and I'm off the west side. I was in Bob's area. Ask Bob, what happened to the ladies' center on the corner of Sacramento and Fifth Avenue that he forced to close down to serve African-American women?
Go ahead. Do you have a response to that?
Sacramento and Fifth Avenue. I didn't close anything down over there. I know what you mean, across by Wallace's, where it separates out.
He's gone. All right, let's go to Rodney. Rodney, you're on the Talk of Chicago. You're talking to Bob Fioretti.
Hello, gentlemen.
Hello.
My concern has to do with each time election night, college.
Rodney.
I'm going to try. Yeah.
Okay, start over. Go ahead.
Every time I come and see politicians appeal to the black community, they pretty much tell you things that have been known for years, okay? When I look at the South Suburbs, and that's just one example, black people are getting screwed. You know this, you've known it for years, and quite frankly, I see no compassion as far as actually raising hell about this.
What's your question, Rodney?
The question is, with the disparity in property taxes, what concrete action will you take?
Bob, what concrete action
will
you take?
Well, first of all, there was, I think when the report came out that showed that this was discriminatory in terms of property taxes, they formed a commission. That commission has gone nowhere. I will make sure that we have fairness and not favoritism in our property taxes. We're going to have to change the whole structure at this point. We got to quit taxing people out of the county and start inviting them in.
What about a property tax freeze, as Governor Rauner has proposed? Would you, as a Democratic county board president, support the governor in his request for a property tax freeze that would help?
Well, I think we got to look at what's happening even in the downtown commercial area. Look at the Sears Tower.
But let's talk about the black South Suburbs.
This is why, as that the last gentleman said, why we're getting screwed.
But would you support a property tax freeze?
I think we first of all have to reform the structure, because if we freeze it, I mean, no more raising it right now. Let's look at what the impact is of the commercial area of downtown. What they do, the Sears Tower, prime example. $1.2 billion it was sold for. It's valued, assessed value is about half of that. And who has to pay for the difference? Everybody in the neighborhoods. And it's not only the people in the city of Chicago, it's the people across this county that pay for that institutionally racist system. And then when we go into the South Suburbs, we see the same thing, and we see high property taxes. We need to change it right away, now, and let's quit worrying about how we're going to do it. We got to do it across the board, create a fair and just system in terms of property taxes and payments.
Esther, you're on the Talk of Chicago. You're talking about Fioretti.
I have six quick questions.
There's not six quick questions. You got one.
Are they yes or no?
Not six. One. Go. I know they handed you a script. You get one.
Well,
you want me to come back?
He fooled us three times. And I wonder why he thinks with such an extreme unreliability, why should anyone vote for him for Cook County president? And did he ever participate in selecting a commission to investigate police torture with Kwame Raoul?
Ooh, uh-oh. Go ahead.
I didn't know Kwame Raoul was so interested in police torture. I've been quite outspoken on the issues of police brutality throughout our community. I have said it over and over again. So I don't know what the last caller was actually talking about. So
what have your issues been on police reform? Where have you been on that?
I think, you know, we should implement the recommendations and go forward.
Okay. The recommendations of who?
The Department of Justice report of what they said a long time ago.
All right. Let's go to James. You're on the top of Chicago.
Good morning, guys.
Good morning.
I supported you, Bob Fioretti. My family and I supported you in the Second Ward when we lived in the area of Rockwell. We supported you because we thought that you would be different than the former than the alderman that you ran against, Madeline Hayscock, which we thought you would protect the black belt. Come to find out that you did not protect the black belt. And then lastly, would you tell the WVON family now, if elected, would you support Rahm Emanuel in 2019?
Well, you know, I know...
Thanks, James.
Thank you. I'm not sure how I did not protect the black belt. That is by far, I have stood up a number of times. If you are in the Rockwell area, because that's not the name of it anymore, you understand that I stood up and stopping the violence in the area, making sure that we had people that have been long ago, I've said over and over on the CHA housing that this transformation should have been done during the terms, and it should not have gone on, and it's still going on. People, the longer they are away from their communities and away from their homes, they never come back. So I understand where you're coming from.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are talking to candidate for Cook County Board President Bob Fioretti. When we come back, we'll wrap up. You got questions, give us a call, 773-591-1690. We'll ask some more questions, and then we'll give you an opportunity to close. It's the Talk of Chicago. Traffic and weather is next.
More of the morning.
Oh, I gotta do the turkey. Gotta do the turkey. Hey, y'all, don't forget the turkey run, turkey giveaway. We gotta do that.
It just seems to me that if you freeze the property tax system, you force reform.
What?
But if you think you're going to reform it while it's still things are going up and out of control, I don't know what that happens. I say you stop everything. It's okay, we're going to stop any property tax increases.
When I ran for the Senate, I did say to freeze the property taxes.
And then, but why aren't you saying it now?
Well, because I think is when I'm Cook County Board President, I think we can change it immediately. There are things that we can do. And
but the assessor is under the county charter, if you will,
right,
whatever they call it. It's
right,
a separate office. You can't do that without changing county.
I do have concerns
charter
about how quick we can do things. We are forcing people out of the Cook County because of this.
And they're killing them. They can't even sell their houses.
And the board, especially by our unelected boards, the Board of Education raises property taxes. The Park District.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is that
and I'm coming to what you're saying. I do believe that if we freeze it, I mean, we have to set a deadline on how soon we should do this.
I find the Democratic Party establishment in Cook County rejecting things only because
they want to
this guy said it.
Right.
And you don't want to give him any credit. You reject it, even though it makes absolute sense, not only in Cook County, but downstate,
right,
where people are getting killed by property taxes. Everywhere. Freeze it and say, okay, bam. If you want to increase money for your schools, have a vote in that jurisdiction, and you can do that. But you no longer can have local government bodies raising property taxes the way they've been doing it. They just do it when they want to do it. And the politicians are doing it, and the people are there left having to pay.
The governor is saying,
if you want to do it, have a vote,
right,
of the people. But it's frozen but that will to make everybody begin looking at the system and finding out why we're paying property taxes to townships. Why are we paying, why are people having two and three school districts on their property tax bill? Why isn't there any more government consolidation? There's a lot of things that statement, freeze property taxes, says about reforming government that you're talking about. You force reform. And they're only rejecting it because a Republican said do it. And as an independent, I'm saying, wait a minute, that's politics over good government. They're putting politics over good government. I know Democrats don't like Republicans. I know Republicans don't like Democrats because they do a lot of the same stuff. But I mean, this is getting ridiculous, and people are having to pay these incredibly high property taxes, higher than their mortgage, and you guys just sit there and have a political fight because you don't want to give the governor credit when he says something right. He says a lot of wrong stuff. I get that. But that is going to have to. People in the south suburbs are losing their homes. These are real good, solid black middle class people who are losing their homes and can't sell their homes because of this thing.
We had war night, and contrary to I'm not sure who's calling in and who's not, and I'm somewhat amazed. I always had war night, and I four times a month, every Monday, and I had legal night twice a month, and I had expert attorneys and former judges that helped people stay in their homes. And yes, they were on the south and west sides primarily. Yes, we had people from the downtown.
When we come back, we're back, and we'll go on to the phone line. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building, and we are talking to candidate for Cook County Board President Bob Fioretti. We got a bank full of phone calls. Callers, Bill, you're on the Talk of Chicago 1690 AM.
I hope you're willing to suggest that we need a new, fresh set of eyes on the fifth floor at City Hall to look at the financial issues of the city, meaning we need a new mayor, period, in the story. I hope you're willing to agree with that because the financial issues have not, they've improved a little bit, but not to the degree that it really helps black folks in terms of how TIF money is spent, the taxing policy, the investment, like you say, going to Amazon in terms of those kickbacks.
Bill, what's your question, bro?
Go ahead.
Bill, what's your question?
Oh, that is the question. I'm hoping he's willing to suggest that we need a new, fresh set of eyes on the fifth floor at City Hall, meaning Rahm Emanuel needs to be replaced.
Okay, but Bill, he is running for county board president, but I guess Bill is asking, would you support the replacement of Mayor May?
I think sometimes 8 years for any office, whether it's county president or mayor, they all have to go.
Is it time for Mayor Emanuel to go?
They all have to go.
Is it time for Mayor Emanuel to go?
They all have to go. Yes.
Yes. Oh, that's all I want to know. Answer the question. Lucille, you're on the Talk of Chicago 1690. Hard to get them answers. Go ahead, Lucille.
Yes, I would like to ask Bob Fioretti, how did he feel and what was his opinion of the shooting of the Pond McDonald?
Bob, your thoughts? Yeah,
I think the department has problems that could have been solved a long time ago, and that shooting should never have happened.
What do you think about Mayor Emanuel? Do you think he covered it up?
I think there was more than a cover up here. People knew it. You know, there's a cover up that's continuing to today.
So you think Mayor Emanuel was involved in that cover up?
I think. As high up as they go.
Did he handle?
Day one, they knew what happened.
Wow, in 16.
So, are you saying that the mayor knew what was on that tape from the beginning?
I think they.
Did he hold it back from the election?
I think they were informed of what happened. Ed Burke was asked a question of finance, and he said the tape was too inflammatory to show. A few months before, the city council approved a shooting case. Where an individual was shot in the back, and the police officer was on top of him shooting the individual until he
died. I mean, it's even, that was pretty egregious at that time, and nobody ever said anything. When I look at the Laquan McDonald tape, we are all appalled, of course. But this was an officer that if he had proper supervision, training, continued training, this should never, never have happened. And that's the problem. We don't have enough supervision, enough training, enough hiring in terms of what needs to be done of our police department to restore the trust of our community.
Brother Nasir. Brother Nasir, you're on the Talk of Chicago. Going, going, gone. Andre. You're on the Talk of Chicago, 1690.
Good morning, good morning. When Mark Wallace was looking for a black lawyer to stand up to defend the black, the suffering of the red light camera to black people, Bob, I want to thank you. No one stood up, first of all, but I want to thank you, Bob, for standing up and taking the lead and standing by Mark Wallace to not only sue, but to win for the red light camera.
Hold on, you had something to do with the red light camera lawsuit? What's up with that?
Well, I actually found the attorneys to help on the issue, and they were the ones that succeeded and on the resolution of and the settlement with the city of Chicago.
You got some points, man.
And I have to tell you, I've been against red light cameras from day one, and I'm still against them on day two, and I will be against them throughout the county.
Real quick, when we were on break, you talked to us about some case and that you had worked on for black families at the in the past? Well, adoption case? Real quick.
The Baby Tamia case, which we brought back Baby Tamia into the, it was an unfortunate set of circumstances. I was told at one of the press conferences that we wouldn't, one of the reporters, Mary Mitchell, had talked to many of the other black adoption lawyers and that we would never get the baby back. I said we would. Not only did we get the baby back within 90 to 120 days, but we changed the law in the state of Illinois to stop this wholesale selling of and primarily African-American inner-city babies out to Utah.
All right. Bob Fioretti, you got 1 minute to close. Give us a close. If you had a chance to talk to the black community, what would you say?
I've heard some of the concerns. I will make sure that everyone is represented in county government. We can't keep making these decisions that force people out. We need to bring jobs and opportunity to our communities. I think a new day. If 8 years ago, I voted just as many of the voters in Cook County did for one view, and we got another. Sadly, we have learned that here in Cook County, a penny saved is not a penny earned. It's a penny taxed. And we have to stop the regressive taxing of our communities, and especially those that are poor and those that are least able to afford it. We need to find the jobs, education, and safety in our communities.
NTA, were you around for NTA, National Teachers Academy? Was that your district?
Yeah, it was across the street.
And so what's your thought on NTA, National Teachers Academy?
You know what, I am opposed to what's happening on it, and the more I look at it, I was in favor and I called for a brand new school in that area. We had the funds. Instead of giving the money to the DePaul Stadium, which then shifted down to McCormick Place, down to Navy Pier, we could have built a school. We had the boundary line set up from Madison to incorporate Far West Side, Bronzeville, and Chinatown. We had enough students to create a neighborhood high school that people could have been within reasonable transportation and walking distance. We didn't need what we were
saying. Bob, we have to have you back. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Talk of Chicago, 7:59. When we come back after news, traffic, and weather, it's time for yoga. We'll recap this conversation. Plus, we got more topics. It's the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM.
Hi, my name is Taylor Wallace in the 8th grade going at National Teachers Academy. Please save my school.
The Talk of Chicago and the voice.
Bob.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it, man.
Definitely.
Thank you for coming in.
Need any help, just call.
You got it.
All right. Whenever you got something to say, man, you know you can say it to the people. You always say it right here.
Well, like I said, I called on when the day you guys had George Blakemore.
Yeah, you sure did. You sure did. He did.
George,
go stand right there and just go ahead and say what. Sit right there so you can get it on the camera about George Blakemore, because you experienced George Blakemore in city council oftentimes. Talk to me about what you think of George Blakemore.
George is a very sophisticated, understands the issues,
Alderman always looked to the side because he delves into the minutia. He gets out there. Maybe it is in terms of his delivery that isn't the best, but he is one who is at all the city council meetings, all the committee meetings, and he understands issues better than many of the aldermen, if not all.
We didn't ask you the big major.
Oh, damn, black staff. Do you have black staff?
Oh, yeah, I do.
In the high levels. Give me, who's your staff? You got black campaign manager, black communications director. Who's on your team that's black that counts?
We're putting it all together, and yes, I have Ebony Lucas is my campaign chair. My co-chair for finance is Willie Wilson. And I have two other people with him that are white. Mark Wallace introduced Willie yesterday. And so I've got Emma Young. She's
doing, I thought you were going to say Emma Mitz. Ooh.
No, not Emma Mitz. Emma Young, she's helping on the communications.
Yeah, crafting. The mayor asked about you yesterday. He asked specifically about your campaign yesterday.
Who did? Event.
Mayor Emanuel.
Asked about his campaign?
Asked specifically about your campaign yesterday. So I was just curious. I'm not going to highlight the details of it, but he asked specifically someone that I know what were their thoughts on your campaign. And so I was just curious to know if he was going to be supporting.
He knows that you're probably ahead in the polls right now.
Mm-hmm.
Because he knows because Rom, his people, they do a lot of polls.
Oh yeah, they do. They don't do anything. They don't walk out the door without polling.
Thank you, man. That is so true.
Bob, talk to me about your experience in city council. Why do you think that there has been such a challenge for black elected officials to bring or deliver resources to their communities?
Because they're all under the thumb. They can't get elected unless they do what the power structure wants. Independent voices get crushed in the community. We don't have independent voices from any of the, not only in the black wards, but the white wards too. Nobody wants to step out unless you have the approval from on high. This is a strong council, weak mayor. People forget that. And when they stand up and they, pontificate, you see it. Somebody here, they give you the thing to the alderman, and you read this. Watch the budget approval.
Dang, I was just going to say something about that. It was funny because I watched a statement come out last week, and it was like it was released by the mayor's office with the quote for the alderman already in it. Bob, so where did your beef... So what made them move your ward? I mean, obviously, what made them move it? I mean, bro, they picked it up and took it and put it somewhere else.
North, yes.
Why?
Because they knew I wasn't going to move from my house that I lived on the west side and now called the West Loop.
That's best. That has one of the most beautiful houses in Chicago, by the way.
Yeah.
It is, man. Yeah. That is beautiful.
Go. But we're going to loop. We only...
They thought you'd be running for mayor. And went because you had second ward was deep, man. That's right.
Why did they kick you out? You had to go.
I mean, they kicked me out. I mean, seriously, because they did not want an independent voice in the council.
They didn't want a mayor. This guy could have run for mayor. That ward, man.
Let him he did finish. Why? So, what was the process that moved you up out of there?
They came up with a structure. And under the remap and. The second ward, historic black ward.
That's what I was trying to get to.
Since 1915, moved the whole thing out, and again, it severed black relations in this city.
Thank you. That's what I was trying to get to.
It did that too, but it also had an opportunity where you had...
I'm going to start saying stuff. I'm going to start acting up too, right? Like,
you had the core of a coalition.
Let the man in.
Right. It was right there, man.
I know.
Everything, man.
Bob, we gotta wrap up.
Okay, man.
All right, I'm out of here.
All right, Bob.
Thank you. Have a good anniversary.
Wait. Go ahead, so she can see. Go ahead.
Have a great anniversary, and if you want to talk about women and men within the same household, bring your wife on, I'll bring mine, and then we can have a real debate about
who runs the fans in the house.
You got it.
That's good stuff. All right, Bob, thank you, man.
Thanks.
Appreciate you coming in. And we'll talk to you more often in the future, all right?
You got it. Okay. Absolutely.
All right.
Thanks.
So, let me tell you, check this out, right? Bob Fioretti could have given a class on how the remap system works, right? So they literally took, what you could have learned is that Bob Fioretti was a victim of the remap process and how important it is in electing people. So they literally took and wiped the historic first black congressman since Reconstruction, the historic second ward.
First alderman.
If you have watched Poli Sci, Poli Sci took place for 90% of what took place in Poli Sci was in that ward that they took from Bob Fioretti. So, you should, and there's a historic lesson. I was kind of crazy that the black folks elected him because Madeline Hathcock, who was Bobby Rush's handpicked person, lost to him, and black folks supported him overwhelmingly. Hey, man, interesting stuff there. I would have loved, on the podcast, we're going to break him down and have him go through the steps that led to him becoming a sworn enemy of the Dailies, so much so that they were willing to move his whole ward to do it. All right, y'all, it's time, yoga. Just start being more assertive. Baby, bend over. Watching, I'ma show ya. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. But you know how we do in 8 o'clock hour. When you hear the beat drop, you know I'm getting my stretch on in the 8 o'clock hour. That's what we got to do. It is the WVON morning show. We got our yoga. Now, I cannot do this show without saying what's up to the WVON morning team. Gotta say what's up to Annette Flournoy in the newsroom. Plus, the musical conductor of the Soul Plane, Miss Sonia Escobar. And y'all, the man, he back. He back over there. He, in a minute, he'll come in here and interrupt us. Plus, Charles Thomas. Now, Charles, we won the turkey race yesterday. Because you know our turkey is say, gobble, gobble, mofo. Right? Everybody else be gobble, 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 gobble. Well, ladies and gentlemen, when you hear the turkeys gobble, means it's time for you to, the fourth caller has to call in and you will be entered into a chance to win the turkey race. The turkey run, turkey race. Now you get to pick one of the turkeys, race, and you can win a free turkey. Now who is the turkeys courtesy of? You know what? The turkeys are courtesy. You know a Harold's Chicken selling turkey now. Hell's Chicken. Hell's Chicken.
Did they fry them? They bread them and fry them?
Number 88. Hey, man. I'm thinking, can we make a fried turkey with mild sauce? What you think that'll taste like? Look, you know what? I'm going to go in for Thanksgiving. What if we went to Harold's and they said, hey, you want a fried turkey, fried hard? What you want, dark or light? With salt, pepper, mild, and they bread it? Have you ever had a breaded turkey wing?
Never.
We may have to try that. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, don't forget, when you hear the sounder, it is time for the turkey race contest. Charles?
I just wrote the column on
Fioretti. I saw you scribbling, okay, man.
I wrote here, I just spent the last hour sitting alongside the ham sandwich.
Damn!
Who, if the election were held today, could dethrone Queen Sugar. The election were held today.
You left a whole bunch of this.
Keep in mind that if Bob Fioretti doesn't come up with some money to tell his story, and she comes up with a lot of money to tell
Bloomberg.
Her story, he is going to have to become not a ham sandwich, but a chicken parmesan sandwich. You know, in order to pull this off, I think he can do it if he gets the money to buy the Reggiano and the...
He got to buy him a Harold's, man. He got to buy him a house.
He's got to come up with something to become more than just a ham sandwich to beat her. But I think she's beatable because of this pop tax thing. I think she's so damaged, her reputation, her political whatever, that she can be had. And he doesn't need a lot of money, just enough to...
Well, he got Willie Wilson, man. He got a little money.
He got a little money, but he's going to have to kick it up to make it chicken parmesan instead of ham sandwich. That's my take on it.
Did you? Oh my God! Did you call? The man ain't even out the building yet. I think you called him a ham sandwich before he get in the car and listen to the radio.
I called him a ham sandwich
while he was sitting there
a month and a half ago because I didn't know who it was going to be. But I think a ham sandwich could beat her today, because keep in mind she hasn't really campaigned or told her story beyond the pop tax. The pop tax, keep in mind, is still in effect. I'm still driving to Indiana to get my stuff. I pick up my gas too when I'm over there, but I'm still driving to Indiana and to DuPage County, anywhere, but to pay these people penny an ounce, because I like that dyed ginger ale.
I
loves it. I likes it.
So, Charles, you know, I asked this question during the interview, but I gotta ask again. Do you think the entry of Bob Fioretti into this race, you know, Tony Preckwinkle hasn't been a very nice person. Do you think this will make her nicer or nastier?
Nicer. I mean, nicer. She's going to have to be nicer. She's going to have to go out and pull it together because, like I said, if he becomes a chicken parmesan sandwich, she's going to lose.
Well, let me ask the
ham sandwich, she's got a shot. But she's going to have to, you know, she's going to have to be nice to people. She can't just go out here.
Man, she'd be on the phone calling, saying nasty stuff about people all the time.
But that's just in your sphere. Keep in mind, she's elsewhere being nice, saying, can you help me, can you help me? Because she knows that she caused herself a lot of self-inflicted damage with the pop tax. She realizes that now.
You think she realizes that?
Oh, she would never do that again, not in this election cycle. Now, if she gets reelected, she might try some other...
Now, do you think if Tony Preckwin gets reelected...
Potato chips or whatever, because she's shown that propensity to do that.
So you think she's hard-headed?
I know she's hard-headed. I mean, she look at how she held on to that pop tax when it was clear that 87% of the people didn't want it. She was still trying to sell it.
So WVON listening audience, you just had the opportunity to watch or listen to the interview of Bob Fioretti. He is the other candidate for Cook County Board President. What you think? Ham sandwich. Charles said, ladies and gentlemen, we have just met the ham sandwich that will defeat Queen Sugar.
You think that can make a chicken parmesan?
You think they can make a combo meal with that? Like a queen, you get you a chicken parmesan and a queen sugar on the side, and a
20 ounce thing of pop.
Right.
With sugar. But he's going to have to come up with a little bit more than just the ham sandwich. Today, the ham sandwich would beat him. Today, that ham sandwich would win.
You think he would beat her right now?
Right now, I believe he would beat her.
WVON.
Right now.
I'm feeling Negrotific.
Right now.
Negro Tiffany. Right now, I don't think Queen Sugar might not come back on our show.
Well, I don't care. I mean, I don't care if she didn't come back.
WVON.
I'm here to report the news.
I'm here to be subjective. I'm not reporting.
I'm a little subjective, too, I got to say. That was a subjective comment. But at the same time, I think that she really damaged herself. Now, she has time to rehabilitate herself, to talk about criminal justice reform, to talk about, you know.
What's she going
to
say about property taxes, though?
That's a problem.
I mean, because, Charles, this is what I'm saying.
She's still in league with that guy, Berrio.
She's going to roll in and say, oh, y'all ain't paying enough property tax. So, I guess, see, because here's the other thing that I'm telling you is about to happen. There is going to be this overwhelming, we need to be blackly unified.
Mm-hmm.
And black people, mm-hmm. we cannot allow working mm-hmm. with this guy because we'll lose everything. Remember, that's mm-hmm. what Boykin told us. Right. He was convinced that we would lose everything. But then I would have to ask, because you know a lot of black committeemen call me, and you know what they say? Man, I ain't got nothing from Tony Preckwinkle. I don't got no. So I guess my question, Charles, is, you think that Bob Fioretti right now could beat Queen Sugar?
I think a lot of people could beat Queen Sugar right now. But any seasoned politician knows that she's got time to rehabilitate herself. And she's going to use ads. She's going to use everything she can to do that. And that's why you got to up your game if you expect to face her in March. You just can't go out there as ham sandwich on day one.
Well, he got Willie Wilson, man. Got your boy.
That was a little cheese. He got a little cheese.
Oh.
That's a little cheese for the parmesan.
What gives him a chicken breast?
You got to get a little breading on it, a little cheese.
All right, so he's starting the sandwich.
A little sauce. He's starting the sandwich.
Uh-oh. Well, you know, we're going to talk about this sandwich when we come back. And I'm Charles. I'm feeling Negrotific. I'm starting to feel a little Negrotific. So phone lines, get ready. Because I feel like when we come back, I'm going to run a Negrotific poll. So get ready. Ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to The Talk Chicago. It's 8:17. We'll be back after traffic and weather.
More of the morning show.
All right, you got it. That's funny. The ham sandwich that beats the Queen Sugar
sandwich.
Go ahead. You got the camera.
And you're going to be a little Italian Parmesan. Get a little Parmesan on there, you know. Yeah, because you know he's going to do very well in the suburbs. I got to say something. This tax thing again, I got to go back to that. Anybody in the south suburbs who's living in one of these underwater houses, who votes for, who goes out here and blindly votes for these people who created this situation, I got no sympathy for you. I don't care who you mean, you know, you're going to have to go out there and support people who support, who help you save your life preserver, which is your home. Ain't nothing more important than that. Ain't no jail, ain't no Cook County Hospital, ain't nothing more important to you than the roof over your head. And when you start voting because she says, oh, I need some money for the hospital or for the jail, you ain't going to jail. You got a house to pay for. And you're underwater. And they're killing you for property taxes, making it impossible for you to even sell your house. So if those people have to really begin to vote their interests this time around. And they got to be very, very careful about if they're supporting people who have put them in this predicament. They got to be very careful about that. And they got to look very carefully at who's talking about what will save their number one investment in their life, what you're depending on for your retirement, what you're depending on to put your kids through school, what you're depending on your house. You can't let these people take your house from you, because right now that's a position that, you know, they put you in. So you got to be very careful about that decision as you make it, because I'm telling you, this is a very dangerous situation for a lot of black folks. I was reading in the paper in Crane's magazine the other day that there was a house that Crane's profiled that was selling for $25,000 in Riverdale. Riverdale. Just 20 years ago, Riverdale was all white. Virtually all white. 20, 25 years ago. They said in 1977, that same house that's selling for $25,000 today in Riverdale sold for $25,000 in 1977. And the taxes were had increased all the time. Y'all gonna support the people that created that situation, which is your Cook County? All the people who did that belonged to your Cook County regular Democratic Party. All the people did. Y'all gonna support that? Y'all going for that? That person who lives in that house, $25,000 house? You got to vote your interests.
Levels, 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 levels. You are my level. Body. All right, WVON listeners, have you gotten your tickets to see Stokely, formerly of Mint Condition, for this week's WVON Unplugged Platinum Series? That's right, Thursday night, November 16th at the Hard Rock Cafe, located at 63 West Ontario. Doors open at 6 p.m. Now, I'm going to tell you, Charles, they are going to be celebrating. You know what they told us? Davina said they're going to be celebrating the WVON morning show and our success. They better have a cake or something. Do we get dinner? Do we get dinner with our celebration?
But I gotta tell you, Maze, I'm getting excited after y'all play that song, The Level, man. I started.
What you know about The Level?
I don't know, man. I never heard it before.
You never heard that before?
No.
Well, it's actually his new song. But I'm gonna tell you, you know, sometimes when these artists come to town, they wanna sing all their new stuff. Hey, Stokely, he's gonna be on the line tomorrow, and we're gonna get a commitment from him to sing the old stuff too. Now, Charles. I'm telling you, they got us a section. VIP, if you want to come get VIP.
I usually don't get to sit in those places. I'll be with you, so I'll be able to sit in the VIP.
No. Oh, that's right. You know what, man? I'm going
to
tell you.
You know the reason I don't get to sit in those sections?
Because you was always the police. You was always.
I'm always at home.
And Charles, you know what, man? I had a taste of getting the press, being press and media. It ain't the same.
Oh, man.
It ain't the same as VIP. I think I'd rather stay at VIP. Man, they don't even want to give you when you press sometimes. Dang, but then they say, could you come to our event? Could you talk about it? Ladies and gentlemen, this is WVON Morning Show. Pretty. You don't know about that?
No. Don't know anything about it. What's this?
Pretty brown eyes. You know I see her. You know, that's Stokely right there.
But that's nice. I mean, that's got a little treat something me. To it, you know. It's not this person, you know, these guys that curse women out. You know that.
I'm out, Stokely. You don't know Stokely. Stokely said what?
I'm learning, man. It's a learning experience.
Get him some. What kind of man would I be? Teach him so you can understand. See, Charles think we all be like, slap him, smack him, flip it up, rub it down. Oh, no.
Right.
No, we ain't always about that. Your man Stokely was an honorable brother. He said, what kind of man would I be? He said, he saw a girl walking by. He was like, ooh. Listen.
Yeah, Stokely got a little game.
Heart and a listen. We catch a vibe reminiscing.
Now, how do you go from that to
yearning
inside? How do you go from
what
that?
Kind of man would I be?
Oh, I've heard that.
If I lived unfaithfully.
Oh, I've heard that song. Yeah.
And what kind of Thursday night, y'all. Look, Thursday night. Unplugged. Ooh. Look, I got me a date. We all coming.
Oh, yeah, that's the jam. Yeah, I like that one.
I'm telling you. See, Josh, you ain't know. See,
I've heard that one before.
You heard that at the step of set. Well, did you listen to that with the Ella Fitzgerald mix?
I may have even grabbed Mary and said, baby, let's go dance. Let's get out there.
You think we're going to, you know what, we're going to get our dance on. Ladies and gentlemen, get your tickets. They are available. Go to the WVON website. Go to eventbrite.com. But you have got to be there with us Thursday night for WVON Unplugged. I see Todd in there getting, you know, the man in there getting the attitude. You know why he getting the attitude? Because he in there working on the live broadcast material. We might even have a live broadcast. Charles, it's going down. Now, I'm going to tell you.
But that time of day wouldn't be us. It'd be Chat Daddy.
Chat Daddy. Getting it ready. You know, Chat Daddy got a great audience. So I'm going to tell you guys, you got to get down there early, though, because you know what that traffic is like downtown on a Thursday at 6 o'clock. But you know what? Make a big plan. Bring your family. Get ready to eat, drink, and have a great time. This is WVON Unplugged. But Charles, we just had Roberto Fioretti.
I don't know the Italian.
Right. I think that was the hybrid Spanish version. But anyway, you saying that Fioretti has to be he has to move from a ham sandwich to a
pollo.
No, where's, not pollo. Is it pollo? That's Spanish.
That might be.
That's Spanish.
That's our romance language. But he has to be a chicken parmesan.
Chicken parmesan.
Cheese and sauce on him. He can't just be a ham sandwich.
Tomato sauce. So what do you all think, y'all? What do you think about Bob Fioretti? Would you consider him? We thinking little Negro typically. Is this my man Johnny who still ain't gave me my ribs? You gonna ask me baby back? You know what, Johnny? I don't know.
Happy anniversary. Mays to you and Commissioner Kerry Steele. That's a beautiful thing, man.
Thank you, my brother. They told me thank you, brother.
Absolutely. And I gotta say this. All right, check it out. There's not a lot of time left. You know, Charles said if it were today, well, we're about to go into the deep freeze. January and February are brutal months for campaigning, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And a ham sandwich, don't underestimate it. I mean, you know, the day after, you got Thanksgiving, Christmas, New Year. All right?
You know, you get a leftover
sandwich. Ham sandwiches, man. And all he has to do is look good and talk about, isn't it bad that she just wants to punish you?
Johnny, so let me ask you.
So you talk about putting the ham sandwich in the freezer.
All of that, Charles.
Uh-huh. And freezing it and bringing it back out.
Upgrade your mustard, man. Cheese. Come on now.
Okay, Johnny, let me ask you a question, Johnny. So Negro typically.
Yeah.
Fioretti or Preckwinkle?
I think he has the advantage, and
if you had to make a choice today,
I like what went down with the Stroger situation, so there's, a personal situation there.
So,
I just look at it like that, and I also look at, like I said, he's very comfortable in churches, and not running out, and all that kind of stuff.
You know what, Johnny?
He just sit comfortably at church,
Johnny, you're going to get in trouble, man. And you live in Hyde Park, too. You know them. Thank you. Them fourth waters. No, they phone checking you right now. All right. Green, you're on the top of Chicago, 1690.
Yeah, this is Greg on the south side.
Oh, what's up, Greg, on the south side?
Listen, Tony Perrickle, she is not going to win. She can't redeem herself. She don't have anything coming. She's out of there. Same as Rahm Emanuel and Bruce Rauner. They all
you can't win.
Out next time around. So, Tony Perrickle, when she beat the Todd Stroger, was bad. She got in, she's been raising taxes ever since. Her and Tony Pariah, they attacked the Todd Stroger over Halverson tax. And she's been raising ever since. She's been in there way over Halverson. She taxed the bullets, 5 cents per bullet. She's been doing so much damage to the county because you got people going out of the county for their ammunition.
Dang, Greg. Not Greg. I don't know if that's a win for you talking about people taxing $5 a bullet, 5 cents a bullet. But man, can Tony Preckwinkle win against the ham sandwich? I don't know. Tony, what's that back in the background you playing? Ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to the Talk of Chicago. We want to know. We're feeling Negro Tiffy. It's a ham sandwich versus Tony Preckwinkle. Can she win? I don't know. Ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. We are acting a fool on the morning show. This is the WVON morning show. I'm your host, I'm the host, Charles Thomas? And you, Maze Jackson? No, wait a minute. I'm Maze Jackson. You, Charles Thomas.
I don't want to be Maze Jackson, man.
Man.
I look under my car every day I get in it, man. And all that. No, no.
ladies and gentlemen, you know what? When we come back, it's Charles Thomas's choice. It's Charles's choice. But I don't know if you can win. It is the Talk of Chicago 16. Is Todd coming in here with a ham sandwich? Oh, the man just brought us a ham sandwich. Y'all, the WVON morning show is off the chain. Tune in to Facebook and YouTube Live. We got it going on because you can't win. Cause you can't win. That's why y'all love the WVON morning show. Cause we are the greatest.
I'm Annette Flournoy, and here's what's happening.
That was funny. Go ahead, Charles. You got the camera.
Yeah, I'm trying to talk to
Sonya.
Where's she at?
You can't win.
Okay, always and forever. Yeah, you can't win. No, I think she hasn't. You know how people are. You know, a lot of people in Cook County, Chicago and Cook County, they're gonna kick that Democrat football all the way. You know, when it comes down to next March and they're gonna go with what they know. You know, the party's gonna tell them who to vote for, and they're gonna vote for them. You know, that's what they do in Cook County. I don't anymore. I stopped that, and I only stopped it recently too. But I stopped that. You know, I'm not sold on it anymore. But it's like, I call the average Democratic voter in Cook County Charlie Brown. Charlie Brown and the Democratic Party, Lucy, right? And Lucy gets that football, puts it down, telling Charlie Brown that, hey, it's cool, Charlie, go ahead and kick. And Charlie Brown puts on that blue jersey with the big zero on it, and he runs up to that football, and Lucy goes, like that. Charlie Brown falls flat on his ass. And that's what your Democratic Party voter looks like in Chicago and Cook County. Question is, are you going to believe it again when they talk about these people, the same people who've been doing it to you? Will you let them do it to you one more time? That's the question.
Do it to me one more time. Because it's never enough with a county like ours. Do it to me one more time. Once is never enough in a county like ours. Oh,
that's right. Cook County, man.
Y'all
don't do it to you, boy. So, they want you, man. They will get you.
So y'all do me one more favor, right? I know I've been bugging y'all all day, but you know we got another audience, so can y'all do me a favor? Tweet Commissioner Carrie Steele or send her inbox and let her know
that the
WVON team is with her. Can y'all help her brother out? Because I'm going to tell you, if she wake up this morning and she see all them, it would probably provide her some more inspiration. Right? So help her brother out. Tweet. I know you did it already. Send a tweet. Send a message. Let's trend. Happy anniversary, Carrie. Yes? Help her brother? Could you help her brother? Help a brother out, right? You know I be out here fighting on this show every day, and you know some of the stuff I say don't make it nice and easy for nobody, so help. Look, they done picked up that song.
What's that?
Matter of fact, why don't y'all just send a message to say stay away from Carrie? You can't win. Whoa. John, you don't know about the Wiz, boy. Your black card is revoked. John, remember, did you really say the Wiz? What is the Wiz? You can't win, yo. Woo! Don't stop till you get enough.
Amazing.
This is my whip. See what I tell you. I was getting my groove on.
Oh, that's your groove.
My Michael Jackson, and this here you come. What's up?
So here are your turkeys, just so you don't miss out. If they win, a sentence in there. If they lose, the sentence in there. Okay.
Okay.
Cool.
Hey Todd, you know if anybody in there got Android?
I do.
You can't win.
I'll bring it to you. Just take it, man, because it ain't going to work anyway. I just need
just bring in the cord and just plug it right there.
I'll plug it in here.
Huh?
Just bring the cord in and plug it to the wall. See, I was getting my Michael Jackson. Woo! Yeah. Yeah. Woo! Yeah! Woo! Yeah. I'm sorry. I'm a little hyper today. You can't win. Dang, they said, can a chicken sandwich win? I am doing the most. Y'all, my coffee is kicking in. I think I got a cold brew today. And so when you get the cold brew, it's extra caffeine. Whew, but I'm hot.
My brother. Thanks, man.
There you go.
Thank you, Yoli.
Yeah.
You can't win. I know I don't know the words. Mike, why you trying to strap me to my chair, man? Y'all don't like my... Look, Reese Mo... Reese, I think secretly you got a crush on the man. That's what I think, Reese. You missed your boo. What up, Theo? Thanks, Kang. Hey, yo, these people out here working against... Hey, y'all know what? We got an army out here. Let them know. Work against the wifey. We got a squad. This is my only day to talk about it till I get ready to go.
That won't ever change. Every day, love me your own special way. Tell all my heart away with a smile. Take time to tell me you really care, and we'll share tomorrow together. I'll always love you.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the Top of Chicago, 1690 AM, every day at 8:30. Charles's Choice. Take it away, Charles.
Yeah, that goes out to my little brother, Maze Jackson, on his second wedding anniversary. You know, that love song, that's what they call a goat. You know what I'm saying?
I actually do.
Goat. Man, you can't get up under that.
It's the things that you do. You know what, Charles? That, let me tell you what. I remember sitting in Nicky's Pizza. It used to be Nicky's Pizza. Now it's Nicky's Chinese Food in Hyde Park. Right there, man, listening to my mom and dad as they was being romantic. And we would eat pizza. And he would reach out and grab her hand over this song. And I would be like, one day when I'm an old man, that's going to be my jam. And then when the blue light used to come on, and they would play this in the basement. Remember when the basement parties used to be, man?
Oh, man, yeah.
And they would turn on the light and you would close the party with two slow songs.
That's right.
And when this one came on, you was like, goat. For real. Charles, thank you, my brother.
Okay.
Man. I appreciate you. Hey, but what's that I heard? Did I hear a gobble? Or did I hear a gobble, gobble,
right before
mofo?
Before we went to the break, I heard a gobble, gobble, mofo.
Well, Charles, on the live line, we have Ann Jarrett, and she is ready to play the turkey race with us. Ann, how are you this morning?
Okay, and you, Mae?
I'm great. Now, And you know you have to choose one of the turkeys. Now, you can pick the two-headed turkey, Maize and Charles. Now, our turkey don't gobble. It don't gobble like the regular turkey. It say gobble, gobble, mofo. Now, you can also get Perry Smalls. Hers goes boop, 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 boop. Al Sharpton, Cliff Kelly, or Chad Daddy Sims, or Mark Wallace. Now, I'm going to tell you, and the two-headed gobble, gobble turkey won yesterday. Uh-huh. So I won't be mad if you don't pick us, because the odds are you might not win. But if you do, I'm not mad, because you're going to win either way. You can either win a free turkey, or we got another hookup for you. So which turkey are you picking?
Maze, I think I'm
going to
go with Chat Daddy.
Chat Daddy?
Chat Daddy?
Yes.
Woo-hoo. Are you serious?
Hey, man.
I'm not going to be mad.
That's a bet. That's a bet. That's
all right. Bet. You ready? Let's line them up. On your mark, get set, go!
And we're off in there, up and running, and everybody's coming in the right center, looking real good. Have you ever seen a two-headed turkey? Never have I.
Hell no!
Here we go, coming around track, Mays Jackson and Charles Thomas, the two-headed turkey. Perry Small is in the race as well, Reverend Al Sharpton, Cliff Kelly, Art Sims, Mark Wallace is in, and Mark Wallace holds up a red light camera and flashes everybody. Stop! Go ahead. And we're going back in the race again. Here we go, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Hope you win the seventh turkey. Hope you're going to get one. So dial 07 numbers to get yourself a turkey. And coming around the track, it looks like Perry Small.
Seems like you did not win a free turkey. But let me tell you what. As a WVON listener, we want to make sure everybody walks away a winner. So guess what we got you?
What?
A two-piece mild fried heart with salt and pepper on the side from the Herald's, located at 124 East 35th Street. Now, Ann, you hold on, because Todd is going to get your information for you.
Two-piece?
Man, you know what? They might upgrade it to a bucket.
Yeah, I thought Mark Wallace was coming up really fast on the
I think Mark was...
But then, Perry, you know, it was a very close race. I just want you to know that it was very close.
I'm just telling you
that,
man.
Chad Daddy was third, and he was coming good. He was leading for a minute, and then he kind of fell back.
Well, what happened was, see, when Mark Wallace had hit the stoplight,
mm-hmm.
he kind of psyched out our Chad Daddy. So he stopped, and he couldn't get his momentum back up, and then Perry just zipped around like she flew, you know, because Perry's at the Eiffel Tower right now. So she stopped in to hit the race, and now she's back on her private jet.
And you saw all of that.
Man, you ain't see it?
Man, you know, there's an attorney general, man, in Illinois, man, that might be watching this race real close to find out if we're really doing this somewhere.
Now,
or if we just kind of like making this up.
Hey, man.
Because, you know, the attorney general.
The attorney general.
In Illinois, they watch this kind of stuff.
Really, they don't. Plus, all you got to do is put Madigan on it. They won't look at nothing.
If this one guy gets elected, he might come up over here to check you.
Oh, my God. Please don't check me.
Checked. But, and see, I ain't in it.
See, you instigating them. Look, now that was classic.
My name is Wes. I ain't in this mess.
Ladies and gentlemen.
And I can't do time.
Let me just tell you.
I cannot do time.
See, do y'all want to see how this goes? You see that? See, I was over here.
You can tell.
Minding my own business.
You can tell him.
And then Charles going to tell. He going to remind me that I was getting checked. You know the one thing you cannot tell a black man.
I know what you can tell him.
Wait.
Amazing.
No. Let me not do it. I was about to go. I'm not going to do it. I'm going to tell you. You know what? I have elevated my game. I am larger than this. When they go low, I'm going to go high. So I am not going to take the bait from Charles, who was really putting the meat out there. Because you know
go to hell.
But I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. Okay, so let's go back. Okay, Chicago, please. This has been a rare forum show today. Okay, I just want to know, Negro typically, you heard the ham. Todd came, you know what really cracks me up, Charles? Todd literally came in here with a ham sandwich.
He did.
And started eating. So, Bob Fioretti, Tony Preckwinkle, Charles says that if Bob Fioretti upgrades from ham sandwich to a chicken parmesan, He can take Tony Preckwinkle out. What do you think, Robert?
Good morning. Thanks for taking my call. Preckwinkle beat Todd Strozier with a hot dog.
Did you say she beat him with a hot dog?
After she won recall, in 2010, after she won the election in November, she could not leave the office because she said she didn't have insurance to take care of her husband, who was ill at the time. She had to wait until the day she was sworn in to leave the automatic seat to go to the county board president seat. And we need to connect the dots on Frank. They're both. It's like the choosing the difference between two devils. That's right. Fioretti supported Emmanuel after he lost the race. And what Emmanuel had done to our people in the city of Chicago is irreprehensible. I mean, they have created a situation where we're choosing the best of two evils, or the worst of two evils, however you want to put it.
You know, I always tell people, Charles, that in politics, the choices are not always between right and wrong or good and bad. Sometimes they're between bad and worse or wrong and wronger, and you have to figure out how are you going to advance the best in this situation. You know, I'm going to tell you that I want to watch this race. I'm going to watch this race because, Charles, you know, as we talk about what's in it for the black people, you got to look at, does that mean we have to elect only black candidates, or does that mean that we elect candidates that have made a commitment to the black community directly?
I think it's the latter. I think the Barack Obama experience has taught us that. I'm not saying that we did anything wrong when we went out and voted for Barack Obama and made him the first black president. That's great. I would not change that vote once. But I think we learned something from that. That doesn't necessarily mean or translate into advancement for our people.
So, Charles, what I've seen already is that the Preckwinkle camp is already saying that Fioretti is a Republican. He's voted Republican in the past, all that good stuff. And I think they're going to try and whip up the community.
Saying that Democrat thing?
You got to be Democrat. And you got to hold us and we're going to lose everything. Yeah. Let me say this.
That's the Charlie Brown line.
That's the Charlie Brown. You saying that's Lucy? Say they got the ball and they're going to pull it from us again.
Oh, of course. That's what they do.
So, black folks, can I just suggest this, right? Before we say yes, no, oh, hell no, hell yeah, can we walk down the hill? Can we make both of them work? Can we not make a decision today? Can we just be undecided all the way up and make them work hard instead of just saying, you know what? Today you heard Bob Fioretti for the first time on the county board, president spot. First time we've interviewed him. There's no decision to be made today.
Yo.
There's no decision to be made today. There is an introduction. Now, y'all, we got a whole long campaign. Let's make them work. Put it on the table what you gonna do for black folks.
And you know, there's nothing, no decision to be made in any of these races at this point.
Bingo!
Governors, state's attorney general, none of them.
Black folks, don't take yourself out the game in November when the real prize is in March and in November of next year. Ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the Talk Chicago, 1690 AM. It's 8:48. We'll be back after traffic and weather.
More of the morning show with Mays Jackson coming up.
You get that, y'all? Do you understand that concept? What they want you to do is make a decision today. You know who you are? Let me ask y'all. Let me just give y'all a lesson. When you watch campaigns and when you watch TV and when you watch elections, they don't talk about the Democrats, the people that are supporters. They talk 100% about the undecided. So when you do politics, right, on a campaign, What we do is we identify the people that are going to vote for us. And we say we're not going to talk to them. Those are pluses. They go in our already confirmed category. You don't have to spend any time. There are also the people that say, no, I'm never voting for your candidate. Those are the minuses. You spend no time talking to them either, because no matter what you say, you're not going to convert them. It is the zeros, the people in the middle who have not made a decision, that is where you spend your time. So for instance, when a candidate comes here and tells me that they're knocking on every door because they want every vote, well, check this out. If there's 55,000 homes in your district and you only have a certain amount of days and you're only hitting 8 houses an hour, you're never going to make it. So what you got to do is identify the people that are most likely to vote and spend your time turning them out, but you got to have a number that you got to get to. Most people don't get that, right? So they say, oh, I'm going to campaign with everybody. I'm going to talk to everybody. Go ahead, spend your time. But the only remember, there's only a finite amount of time in a campaign. And oftentimes, the people that talk to you the most, that make you work the hardest to talk to them at the door, are the people that will not show up at the polling place. Now, you can let people tell you all of these other things. You can let them tell you that they got a new theory and a new process. But guess what? It's science. And it's like it's been perfected and it's been taught to people who work the system that was created. So when I hear all these other Mau Mau's talking about, oh, we're going to start another party or we're going to do whatever, that's not a diss. But if they can't tell me how they're going to quadruple the number of signatures that they have to do for a party, they're still running as Democrats. We're back. Oh, no, we're not. No, we're not. No, we're not. So we're not. I'm sorry. So, guys, it's like, I don't just be talking out of the side of my neck. I've lived it. I've done it. I've executed it against people. Now, there are people right now that are encouraging you to do something different, which I agree with. But if they haven't thought about the actual process, like if it's all theory and they haven't put it against a system that was built to whoop their ass, then it's not going to be effective. How many rebellious campaigns have we heard of? How many of them have been successful? How many times have we heard how many people? Do you know any black people that said they liked Mayor Daley? No, not really. But how come every time it was an election, his numbers went up in the black community? People will talk crazy about you supporting Rahm, but the fact of the matter is, in both elections, the only way that Rahm was elected was that black people voted for them. So it ain't the people that's talking the loudest and screaming and yelling. That's the Mau Mau's hear each other. But the average person does not want to be associated as an extreme. They live a middle life. They just want their middle to be a true middle. So, guys, I'm not hating. And it's like, I really hate that people think that it's hate. It is. When I spent my life and career whooping the ass of people like that because they were emotional and not methodical, and I say, hey, guys, be methodical. Did you think about these practical? And it's like, oh, you a sellout, you're Uncle Tom. Well, okay. See how that works for you when it's time to win. See, my premise is elections are not about the fight. You cannot change anything as a loser. So if your plan is not to win, then you got a challenge. It's flawed. It's just like putting social services in front of business. Oh, this is my song to carry. I got married to. I remember walking down the aisle to this. Ooh, I love this song. It's my song to my. It's not just something you take, it's given. You are tuned in to the Top of Chicago, 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. Charles, I do not know where the time goes during these shows, but it's pretty much over, bro.
Yeah, man, but, you know, but it's only the beginning. I mean, like you said, I don't know if you were on the air or off the air, but this is the first time Bob Fioretti has been here. And a lot of candidates haven't been here at all in other races. So, again, I think it's very important that we keep our powder dry.
Now, and break that.
We don't go out there talking about I'm voting for this guy and make the decision today. You can't even make the decision on what party you're gonna vote for today.
Now, I can't say that.
Well, I can say that because I'm an independent.
I keep telling you, brother, you can't be black and independent in Illinois. Well, you're gonna learn that one day. You're gonna learn that one day.
But you're gonna be stuck with the usual suspects then. You're gonna be stuck with the usual suspects if you say that. If you have committed already to a party, you're gonna be voting for one of Madigan's people.
Ooh, so
that's
Charles.
Who's gonna win these primaries, man, you know.
So Charles.
You know that.
I guess this is my thing. Black folks. See, I see everybody up here talking about, oh, Bob Fioretti, he's gone, he's done. Let me just say that if you eliminate any candidate at this point, you have eliminated yourself from having a voice in that race. So, black folks, don't pick now. Make them think. You wonder where this person has been. I bet you this. I bet you if you send an invite to your community forum now, you couldn't get nobody to come. Bet you they'll be coming now. Couldn't get questions about what's going on in the south suburbs? Why don't you send an invite to your community meeting now?
I think too, Mays, you gotta watch your interests. What is your interests? You know, you have to say, hey, is this a property tax issue to me? I'm gonna vote that. Is it a crime issue to me? I'm gonna vote that.
And you know what? And I'm going to say this, you know, because everybody black ain't poor. I think we run the gamut. But I think that if they come in and they talk and they only talk about poor black folks, think about the causes of poverty, right? If you live in the south suburbs, the government is causing a big chunk of your poverty.
Right. And the fact is, you know, there is a philosophy on the part of many politicians. And we've talked about it here. What's the line?
What is it? I'm sorry.
Keep them broke.
Keep them broke. Oh, do it like Tony, though.
Keep them broke, baby.
There it is.
That's what he said, right? And that's what they do. A lot of these politicians want to keep you broke because you keep coming back. You're dependent on them. And we don't want that in our community moving forward. We want to be independent, free. Off the plantation. That's where they kept them on the plantation, right?
Mm.
Sharecroppers. What you do with a sharecropper? Keep them broke.
Baby.
That's
Let's go to saying. Bill real quick. Bill, you got something. You could be our last caller. Go ahead,
yeah,
quick.
I want to tell you something. This is ridiculous. We must have youthful Alzheimer's. Preckwinkle and the other candidate, piece of garbage. Give Todd a nod. He was the one that said a penny tax, and they broke him down and said that. Then Preckwinkle came in, hired some big business people, gave him big salaries. Then she had contractors doing something non-African-American, no answers to the questions of what she was doing, money being spent, no answers for it, and then come up and ask for a vote. No, close Oak Forest Hospital where most seniors cannot afford, most African-American seniors, and they have no place to go, close all of the health facilities all in the suburbs, Phoenix, Harvey, Markham, Dixmoor, Robbins. No.
They didn't close none in Skokie, did they?
Give Todd a nod.
Yeah, you know what?
Oh, I like that line.
I like give Todd a nod. I think Todd is probably out of this one. But I do think that we cannot afford to give a free pass. I think you got to make everybody work. Everybody. So, I'm suggesting, I think Charles would be very interesting to ask Madam Queen what's in it for the black people now. Right? Be interesting to ask.
Oh, she got answers.
That one them papers?
Huh? No, she's got answers. She'll talk about you. You're going to jail. She'll make it better for you in jail. Or maybe you won't get a case. You won't get a bracelet instead of a cell. She'll tell you that you get a free shot at the hospital. She will talk to, basically, poor black people. She won't talk to the black middle class. She's not talking to the black middle class. She's talking to those who need public service. Who are dependent.
I think she's talking to
I'm undocumented. Telling you, man, that's what they do.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you.
Well, them too.
This is the WVON Morning Show. I want to encourage you all to check out Poli-Sci 101 tonight, final edition, rebuilding the black infrastructure. You know what? I don't know where the time goes. But for Annette Flournoy in the newsroom, for Miss Sonia Escobar, the musical conductor of the Soul Plane, for my main man, Charles Thomas, and for me, Maze Jackson. And if you don't like it, you know what you can tell them? You can tell them, happy anniversary, baby. We out of here. It's the Talk of Chicago 1690. I'm your man, Maze Jackson. Peace. First time I've never closed the show without Maze C.
Why is that?
Huh?
Why'd you do that?
Because my wife is, one time I'm giving it to her. She got her last name. Right? She lives, eats, sleeps, and breathes over this show.
Okay, I didn't.
Gave my baby her props one time. All right? Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. Now do me one more favor, one last time. Throughout the day, if y'all feel like y'all got a moment, send some love. And anybody that's hating on my baby, let's get them. All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is the Talk Chicago 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Charles?
Hey, I'm gone, you know. I'm gone. I'll be back. I'll be back tomorrow, hopefully, if they let me.
All right, y'all.
Charles?
Holla back.
What's this? Oh, man. Peace. I ain't never, man. Damn.
Got man, what bag. Man?
What's this, the
bag? What's your name is Todd Renskowski.
Y'all bogus, man.
Man, y'all fast, man.
All right, y'all. I'm out of here. Peace.
Y'all fast. Boy, they fast, man. Damn.